happens.
Sports.
And it is the biggest show on the radio. Mason and Ira, it is on for your Tuesday afternoon.
Champion Dukes here, kid.
Here we go. Happy Tuesday on Swift 710. That's right. The bit continues because it annoys everybody. I'm not even that big of a T-Swizzle person or a Swifty. But we know I like a good bit that fires people up.
Swift 710.
Speaking of Swift 710, we will get the recap from Steve Mason, looking good last night in that picture at SoFi Stadium in his Sunday Swagger polo, taking in a little T-Swizzle. We'll get all the details, plus all the other stuff going on. Johnny Eyes here, Corporate Greg, and yes, producer Brian Cohen on the wheels of steel. Let's get to it for a Tuesday afternoon.
Players going to play.
Exactly.
Haters going to hate.
Mason in Ireland on Swift 710 right now.
Ah!
Good afternoon.
What are the wheels of steel? What is that?
That's the board.
They call that the wheels of steel?
Yeah, you've never heard that before?
Is there
a radio lifer like you?
Is there any steel on the board? I don't think there is there?
Maybe a little bit. You know, yeah, they got some screws and stuff.
Wheels of steel. What is going on, people? By the way, I'll tell you right off the top, we got a four-pack of tickets, a few four-packs of tickets to see LAFC versus Real Salt Lake tonight at BMO Stadium, so make sure you keep on listening for that. So, John, last night, and I heard from multiple people, and you heard from multiple people about this Baltimore Orioles announcer.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah.
All right. So, all these people, like McMenamin texted me saying, this is the most outrageous thing I think I've ever heard.
Yeah, I heard from Dave Singer. I heard from my friend Vivek. I mean, everybody's on this.
All right. So here's the backstory. There's this announcer in Baltimore, young guy. He's kind of their Joe Davis.
Yes.
Named Kevin Brown, who's very highly regarded. He's a young, up-and-coming announcer that a lot of people like. So Kevin Brown hasn't been on the air for a couple of weeks.
Right.
And somebody figured out that the Orioles suspended him for what they say was being overly negative. We pulled the clip where Kevin Brown was supposedly overly negative. And we'll play for you, and you tell me if this is grounds for suspension.
For the Orioles, Brandon Hyde has felt like this has been maybe the toughest ballpark to play in. But the Orioles have a chance to do something special today. They've already clinched at least a split in the series, winning two of the first three. And they could pick up a series win behind Tyler Wells today. It's been a minute. The Orioles split a two-gamer with the Rays in June. They had lost their last 15 series here at Tropicana Field. You have to go back to when our now colleague Brad Brock picked up the win in the series finale June 25th, 2017, the last time the Orioles won a series here at St. Pete. Already got 3-2 at the Trop this year after winning 3 of 18 the previous 3 years combined. It is a stark difference, Ben, and it is not a bad Rays team. It's not like all of a sudden the Rays became slouches in the American League East. They've led this division every day, but now two, and the Orioles once again are back alone in first place.
So what did he say that wasn't factual?
I think if we put the Orioles management on truth serum, what they would say is, why are you, as the Orioles announcer, bringing up the fact that we've lost 15 straight here?
And I would say, what is wrong with you as the Orioles announcer giving this game context? Because that's what he's doing. He's giving it context.
You're 100% right. And the reaction to this around the league has been stunning. Other announcers doing other games, and I mean this, we pulled one of these so you guys could hear it, but this happened all over the league last night. This is Gary Cohen, who is the Mets TV announcer. Him and Keith Hernandez do the Mets games.
Yep.
And the Mets were playing the Cubs. They weren't even playing the Orioles. And right in the middle of the game, here's Gary Cohen.
The Baltimore Orioles organization draped itself in utter humiliation with their treatment of one of their young broadcasters, a guy named Kevin Brown, who is one of the great young talents in broadcasting in this game. That's line to center field, and Bellinger makes the catch, one out. During a recent game at Tropicana Field in St. Petersburg, Kevin, during his opening, talked about how the Orioles had trouble winning in the past at Tropicana Field, but that they were doing better this year. That was really all he said. And for that, the Baltimore Orioles management decided to suspend Kevin Brown. Let me just say one thing to Baltimore Orioles management. You draped yourself in humiliation when you fired John Miller, and you're doing it again. And if you don't want Kevin Brown, there are 29 other teams who do.
Mm. I mean, and this was sentiment.
That is some stern criticism.
Yeah,
right there.
There is sentiment all over. What are the Orioles thinking?
I don't know.
Why don't they just come out and say, you know what? This, we reviewed it, and we feel like this is in the past. We're bringing Kevin back. And
wait a minute. They're not bringing him back?
No.
No, they are. He's coming back Friday. Oh. It came out today that he's coming back Friday.
Right, but why isn't he coming back tonight?
Oh, he should.
But yeah.
For whatever reason, they chose
but
Friday.
But they gave him, what, a two-month cooling-off period?
July 23rd is when he said
July
that.
July 23rd.
So what's today?
Today's about a one-month cooling-off period.
More like 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, more like...
Go
more...
think about what you said. We're not that bad against Tampa.
It's very Artie Moreno.
It is very Artie Moreno. Ding, ding, ding. This is the kind of thing Artie Moreno would do. Like, you're off our little radio dance party
round table. Yeah, some writer from either The Athletic
Sam
or The Register.
Sam Blum.
Greg, where does he write?
He writes for, I think it's The Washington Post?
No.
He's a local guy.
He either writes for the Orange County Register or The Athletic. One of the two. But
yeah.
He,
but they didn't like what
they said
on the round table. And by the way, then all the other reporters said, well, if you don't like Sam, then we're not doing your dance party hoedown panel either.
Yeah, I don't understand when organizations dig in their heels like this. But you're right. The Moreno comparison, Greg, is a good one. If you're the owner.
Who is the owner? Is it still?
Peter Angelos.
It's still Peter Angelos?
Yeah, but I think other people run it for him.
Right.
And like they, you know, Cohen mentioned they fired John Miller when John Miller was considered to be the best baseball announcer in the league. And now they're messing with this guy, Kevin Brown. And what's odd about it is this seems, and Greg, maybe this is them saying that they are fixing it, letting him come back on Friday. But this seems incredibly fixable.
Right.
And they didn't fix it.
Well, and I think that this comes down to a particular issue, which is how we talk about the teams that we cover. So one of the reasons why I stopped doing USC pregame, one of the reasons, was that I didn't want to be in that position where I've got to suck up to USC no matter how things are going.
Right.
I don't work for any teams. So I think that gives me free rein to be critical and to point out mistakes.
I obviously can give a unique perspective to this. I think the Lakers have said to me before, we know we're going to get criticized.
Right.
We don't necessarily think that criticism should come from you. And so I walk that line all the time.
Yeah.
I say, you know, I can describe if they make a bad pass. I can say they made a bad pass. But what Kevin Brown did wasn't criticism.
No, not even. That was out the context for the game.
What he said, I've set up Laker games like that for 20 years.
Yeah.
So that was
every time you do a Clippers-Lakers game, do you not reference that the Clippers have had great success against the Lakers and how many consecutive or how many wins and whatever the Clippers have beaten the Lakers?
Right, but you know, as long as you don't make it personal and you don't do anything like beat the audience over the head with negativity, I think you should be allowed to tell the truth. And
right.
I'm glad I get to do that. This guy, Kevin Brown, obviously can't.
No.
Well, and it was a graphic on the screen that the broadcast put together. He was just looking at the
was
graphic.
Was there really?
There was a graphic on the screen that the broadcast.
My God.
He was just reading off of that.
The broadcast crew put up a graphic of their history against the Tampa Bay Rays.
Yeah.
And he basically just read it out loud, and then he got suspended?
Yeah, so it was already all planned. Like, they already, you know, pre-show stuff. This was already all planned that he was going to say this stuff, too.
So soft.
Yeah, it's
so
very weird.
Soft.
It's very, and what sucks about it is the Orioles are really good this year.
Yeah, they're having a great year.
And for them to make this the story, the Orioles really had to step in it to get any negative things said about the Orioles because they're playing so good.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, very, very weird.
It is weird.
I wonder long term if he'll stay there. I mean, it sounds like he might have options to go someplace else
soon. Yeah, seems like. All right, hey, it's Hollywood Park Casino. No, it's not. It's not Hollywood Park Casino.
Well, you can give away
Fantasy Monday. But I'll do this.
Do the other one.
Want to win a round of golf with John Ireland and Corporate Greg? Terranea Resort and ESPN LA are giving away a round of golf at the links at Terranea and lunch with Ireland and Greg. All you got to do is post a video of your golf swing on Instagram or on Twitter. Tag at ESPN Los Angeles. And when I say we, I mean Ireland and Bergman, because I don't know what a good swing looks like. We'll review the best swings.
We might take a bad swing. We're looking at all swings.
Doesn't matter good or bad. We're looking at it.
Yeah. You could be playing golf with Ireland and Corporate Greg at the links at Terranea. All right, coming up next, who is up in the NFL? Who is down in the NFL? That's coming up next. Mason and Ireland, 710 ESPN.
The Black and Gold dominated in their League's Cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Gallagher, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL Tuesday night. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
So we got Scott Kaplan. And this afternoon show, Susano and Cap. Okay. Scott Kaplan. So we got Scott Kaplan. And this afternoon show, Susano and Cap. Okay. Scott Kaplan.
The confidence is up there. That goes without saying. I've always thought that, you know, where you wear Nikes with a suit, it can be kind of a tacky look. But if you don't wear an undershirt and you wear those glasses, then maybe it pulls it together. So I'm going to give that one, just for the fact that he knows what he's doing, I'm going to give him a 6.
Would you wear that yourself?
No. Never, ever, ever be seen in that.
Honestly, suit's not bad. The no undershirt raises it up a little bit to where I'd probably say 8.5.
Would you wear that fit?
100%.
Shoes on point. I get out of 7 too.
Would you do the same thing? Show the little taco.
I definitely show the chest. Gotta show the chest.
I ain't gonna lie, it's different. You got the Dior shoes on it. The nice hat. I like the glasses. No shirt with the chain. He get a 10.
I give my man an 8. I give him an 8 out of 10. He nice little drip.
Do you think you can pull that off with no shirt?
Coming up in just a few minutes this hour, around 1:45, producer Brian Cohen, Ringo we call him sometimes, is going to spin that wheel, the wheel of questions, up ahead this hour on Mason and Ireland on Swift 710.
All right, you have a fantasy football league and you want to be part of our ultimate fantasy football draft on Friday, August the 18th at Hollywood Park Casino with the 710 crew. You can register now at ESPNLA.com. Be with us for a fantasy party, Hollywood Park Casino, eat, drink, and draft.
Okay, if you listen to the show, you know that we have a group of young guys here who we have been encouraging for a while to branch out on their own and kind of follow in our footsteps. And one of them, Cody Liu, has stepped into the studio.
Clue!
Cody, how you doing?
What's going on, guys?
All right, turn Cody's mic on, Brian.
There we go.
All right, there you go. All right, you got him, Brian? Is it working?
No, grab that one.
Good. There you go. Now we got you. Yep, now we got you. Okay. So, Cody, you do a podcast.
Yes.
With DeAndre and Parker.
The Blueprint.
Okay.
That's a good name.
That is
a good name.
Now, here's the question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this could literally shape the rest of your life.
Yep.
Did you guys copyright the name of that podcast?
We have not.
Oh.
I have some very bad news for you.
What's up?
This is terrible news.
Pau Gasol, the great Pau Gasol, has started a podcast, and he's calling it The Blueprint.
Oh, my gosh. Oh. Are you serious?
Yes. You guys were there first, but you didn't cut. First of all, this is one of the many lessons which we are going to pass down to you. You always have to protect your interests.
Yes.
All right?
And your intellectual property.
You don't see anybody else doing a culture pop podcast.
No, I own that.
SteveMason.com, you know who owns that?
Steve Mason.
Him. Guys. You guys forgot to copyright The Blueprint?
You know who owns The Blueprint?
Hey, for $200, I could have done it for you.
That's Jorge.
Yeah, Jorge said for $200 he would have done it for you.
What do you guys think we should do?
I think you should call I think you should call Jacob and see if you have a case.
Yeah, call Jacob and Ronnie.
He'll be here later today for the station.
He'll be here later today. Are you here today all day?
Yeah, we're
all right, when Jacob comes in, pull him aside for a little side conference, if you know what I mean.
Oh, my gosh.
Clue. P-Bell, D-Hawk, V, Pau Gasol.
Maybe we should ask Pau if he wants to do a collab. Maybe we'll join him.
Yeah, I'm sure he wants to do a collab,
Cody,
with you guys.
He's one of the nicest guys ever. He might actually say
he's a
yes.
Hall of Famer now.
Yeah.
So, I mean. Yeah.
But I can't believe you guys didn't copyright it.
Yeah.
Now, what happens if he copyrights it and then you have to change the name of your podcast?
We'll change it.
No, come on.
We don't want to. Are you just going to roll over and play dead?
It's Pau Gasol, guys.
Yeah, you got to fight for your right to podcast.
All right. We'll fight.
Wait, how many editions of the Blueprint have been recorded?
Five.
How's it going so far?
It's going great.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we're starting to find our rhythm and we're starting to find our voices on the air.
Well, you know what the next episode should be? What should we call this?
What should we do? You know what? That's a pretty interesting thing.
If we get copyrighted out of this
name. By Pau Gasol. Oh, right. Man. Pau Gasol. Yeah. I feel bad, you know? Like, the guy's going to the Hall of Fame. Now we're going to take his podcast.
No. He's taking yours.
He should feel bad for you.
Yeah.
You're not looking at this right. When Jacob comes in, have a conversation.
We're going to have a conversation with Jacob about this.
All right. Good luck.
Excellent. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much. Clue. Yeah, that's...
I saw that and I went, oh, man. I hope Parker and Cody and DeAndre copyrighted that thing, and of course they didn't.
What a bad break that was.
Yeah, but we'll see. Maybe something will come out. Maybe Pau will appear on their blueprint to make things good.
Now that's a good plan. Oh, if Pau went on
that, if
Blueprint B.
Yeah, if Pau went
B-sides.
On if Pau went on Deep their cuts. Edition of the Blueprint, then it might be a, like kind of a make good.
Yeah, right.
And Pau might do it. Pau is I've always said this about Pau Gasol. He is the most down-to-earth famous person I think I've ever met. He's probably one of the five most recognizable athletes in Spain. Okay?
Right.
Couple of soccer players, Rafa Nadal, Pau and Marc Gasol. That's the list. And, Ricky Rubio was from down there and, you know, a couple other guys. But... if Pau walks into a room, everybody goes, oh, that's Pau Gasol.
Oh, nicest guy in the world. And his tweets are really nice, too.
Yeah, but he tweets from the Magic Johnson
School
of Tweeting.
School of Golly Gee.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, no, but I think in...
But, and the difference
it's
is...
completely honest with him. He's not putting anything on.
And I think he actually does his own tweets. I think somebody is tweeting for Magic.
Oh, you think?
But I don't think anybody's tweeting for Pau, do you?
No. Pau's saying nice things all on his own. All right, so it is just about NFL season. What are we, like 30 days
No,
away?
It starts on Saturday. What is wrong with you?
Oh, it starts on Saturday. Yeah,
that doesn't count.
Starts on Saturday.
Hey, we're carrying the game, Mr. Program
That's
Director.
That's totally fine. But
what do you mean it doesn't count?
Because they're not going to play anybody.
Stafford
playing
true.
Again?
No,
they
true,
are. They're playing
true,
some.
True,
Stafford Donald Cup not playing.
Not playing. But
Correct.
Everybody else
How
out there, a lot of guys
way,
fighting
Greg,
for jobs.
None of the good guys are playing.
Right, yeah.
None of the guys from last year
The pillars of the franchise will not be on the field, but you'll see a lot of guys scrapping for gigs.
Yep, no, absolutely. Well, that's because 35% of the team is new guys.
So I've got a list, looks like Yahoo, of the, and I'll ask you ultimately about the Raiders and the Rams, but for right now, power rankings... Too early, but power rankings in the NFL for this year, obviously, there's some obvious ones, clearly.
Okay, number one is Kansas City.
Number one is Kansas City.
Number two is either Cincinnati or Philadelphia.
Well, you've got number two and number three there. Philly number two and the Bengals number three.
All right, now it gets Buffalo. Subjective. Hold on. I don't think Buffalo is ahead of San Francisco.
I do.
Buffalo four, San Francisco five.
Okay, so right there, we got the top five.
Got the top five.
All right, now it gets... What do we do with the AFC East? We already got Buffalo in there.
Right. I mean, the Dolphins are probably closer there, and then the Jets probably moved
Dolphins,
up because of Aaron Rodgers.
Jags...
Jags. Well, I mean, the Jags won a playoff game last year.
Yeah.
They're also not in the.
Have we mentioned the name of number six yet?
You've mentioned the name. No, you have not mentioned the name of number six.
Really?
Yeah.
So it's not an NFC team.
No, it can't be Cleveland, right?
No. Let me steer you the right direction. It is an NFC team.
It is an NFC team.
Yeah, at number six.
It's not the Cowboys.
No, I think it might be the Lions.
Oh, really?
Is it the Lions?
Lions number seven, Cowboys number six.
Yeah, okay. We got both of them.
Told you the Lions.
So do you think that the Chargers are going to be in that top 10?
Oh yeah,
Brian.
Looking Brian.
That's a great question. are the Chargers.
I don't think they're going to give them that benefit of the doubt because they give them the benefit of the doubt every year. It's like the Clippers. They never go anywhere.
That's true. But I think they could be like number 10.
So is 9 and 10 AFC?
9 and 10... 8, 9, and 10 are all AFC.
So it's probably the NFC East. Some of those AFC East teams are probably there.
But hold on. It's either would you rather go Jets or Dolphins or Chargers?
I would probably rather go Dolphins there.
All right, let's do the Dolphins.
Dolphins number 9.
Okay.
So you're missing 8 and 10.
All right, so let's do the Jets because they've got to be one of them.
Jets are number 8.
Okay.
Okay.
So you've got one last one, number 10.
In all right, the AFC. Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
I know they don't have like tons of name players, but aren't the Ravens always there Lamar Jackson?
Yeah, they are. It's just so tough.
Well, okay. What about the Jags?
The Jags. I don't think
do we have any strikes yet.
No strikes.
Let's try the Jags.
Okay.
Jags
number 12.
Number 12. So they were close.
Yeah, right in the ballpark.
I mean, I would try. What was the team? The Ravens.
Ravens or Chargers?
I'd go Chargers over the Ravens.
Or the Browns.
Not the Browns.
Chargers.
Chargers.
Let's go Chargers. Are number 13.
All right, so now it's down. It's
look at it, Brian. He's upset.
Yeah, that doesn't seem right.
That doesn't seem right to you, Brian?
No, that doesn't seem well.
Greg, I think it's down to the Browns or the Ravens. Who's better?
Did we already say that? We didn't say the Ravens. Who's
we didn't
Browns?
Say we have.
See, I just don't ever think the Browns are going to be in there. Sorry, Lindsay. But I would between the two, I would take the Ravens.
Brian, what do you think?
I would take the Ravens, too.
All right, let's try Ravens.
Boom! That's correct. Yes, that is number 10. It is the Baltimore Ravens.
So, we did pretty good.
Very good. Chargers are number 13. You were talking about the Browns a lot.
Who was 11?
They're number 14. Number 11 is Seattle. Number 12 is
Jacksonville.
Oh,
Seattle's way too high.
Yeah,
I agree. Seattle is going to lose in week one. Let's see.
You don't want that.
Being optimistic. No, I do.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I do. I want to win. I want to win. Let's see. Where are the Raiders? Are number 24?
Sounds just
what are the Rams?
The Rams are number 28.
I think the Raiders are going to have a worse record than the Rams.
Do you?
I do. I think the Raiders might be tanking. Did you guys see that story I sent you about Josh Jacobs?
Yeah,
if they let him go, you're 100% tanking.
So who was that? Was it Mike Florio who suggested that?
Yeah, suggested that they would rescind the franchise tag that was offered to Josh Jacobs and say, hail fellow, well met.
If they do that.
Then they're full-on tank.
Yeah.
Josh Jacobs touched the ball more than any running back in the National Football League last year. He was so unbelievably valuable. He won my fantasy football league for me.
After I traded him to you for
Alan Lazard.
Alan Lazard caught touchdowns in the first 3 weeks I traded for him. I go, I picked Mason's pocket, and then Josh Jacobs won the rushing title.
Went nuts. See, here's the thing about tanking. I don't know if it's a successful strategy. Like, can you actually tank? Can you guarantee yourself the number one pick? I don't think you can.
It worked for the Colts when they let Peyton Manning go to Denver to get Andrew Luck, and Andrew Luck led him to the playoffs. And, you know, Andrew Luck obviously retired early, but it worked for them. You're right, though. It is risky because it doesn't – you can't
because you could suck you can't, and not get
yeah,
Caleb.
You can't tell the players –
like don't play
year,
hard.
1 year I got knocked out of Survivor.
Mm-hmm.
I was down to me and one other guy. And the guy called me and goes, you want to chop?
Yeah.
And I said, have you taken the Rams yet? And he said, yes, I've taken the Rams. I said, normally I would chop, but the Rams play the Jets at SoFi this weekend and they're 17.5-point favorites, so I can't do it. And the Jets won the game. It was probably
really?
3-4 years ago.
Oh,
yeah,
God.
It was when they were in SoFi. So they've only been there for like 4 years.
Right? Yeah, right. Since,
and they knocked me out, and I finished second. Got no money.
Yeah,
but I did it to myself.
I always chop when given an opportunity.
Yeah,
I chop.
I would now.
I don't want to get greedy. Obviously, you would in retrospect.
Yeah, but I had the Rams, and he didn't. And the Rams were 17.5-point favorites at home. That may have been the year the Rams won the Super Bowl.
Was that 2021?
Yeah, it may have been
2021.
Yeah, I think it was in the 2020 year, and they just the Rams laid an egg for 1 week, and lost at home to the Jets. Wow. And by the way, it cost the Jets the number one overall pick.
Oh, did it?
Yeah.
Yeah, see,
so you can't...
December 20th, 2020, the Jets beat the Rams 23-20.
Yeah, and I had...
At SoFi.
Yeah. No, you were probably there.
I was there, for sure.
Well, you may have gone home for Christmas.
No, I may have psychologically blocked. I don't go home for Christmas anymore.
Well, home is here. Your mom's here.
Exactly. Yeah. I stay home for Christmas. Yeah, so there you have it. There's a little... Yeah, I think the Rams... I don't believe the Rams are in tank mode. I don't think... As long as they bring Josh Jacobs back, I do not think the Raiders are in tank mode. And I think it is a very inexact science figuring out how to have the worst record in the league.
So I heard someone say it today. I don't remember who it was for some reason, but Jimmy Garoppolo has never had a 1,000-yard receiver.
Never.
Never had a 1,000-yard receiver.
Debo never had a 1,000 yards, huh?
No.
Huh. Wow.
Never. So Devontae Adams.
Devontae Adams.
Who is if maybe not the best wide receiver in NFL, and has like three or four 1,500-yard seasons in a row or whatever it is, still will not get 1,000 yards? That's wild.
Yeah. No, that is. 6-11.
Oh, that's a terrible spot to be.
I know. You don't want to be
0-17.
I know you don't want to be, but I think that's where they're going to be.
0-17.
I don't think they can win six games if they don't have Josh Jacobs.
I think they'll have Josh Jacobs.
He'll just come in?
Yeah,
he'll pull a Saquon Barkley?
Like a Saquon Barkley. I mean, ultimately, nobody wants to be Le'Veon Bell, sit out a year, and then never be the same.
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah.
Because there's a couple of these guys threatening to do just that.
Now, it's Jonathan Taylor and Josh Jacobs. Those are the two guys that are the holdouts among the running backs.
Both really good?
Yeah. All right, coming up next for you. I don't actually have that, but coming up next for you is the Wheel of Questions. We will spin the wheel, see what pops up. Also, 2 o'clock call of the day. Be thinking about everything we're talking about. In fact, if you are a great 2 o'clock call of the day, why don't we give the best 2 o'clock call of the day a 4-pack of tickets, see LAFC tonight versus Real Salt Lake at BMO Stadium. We'll do that coming up for you at 2 o'clock. Mason, Ireland, 710 ESPN. Let me tell you about my friend Jacob Imrani. So I was in an accident a couple of years ago, and the very first thing I did from the scene of the accident was that I called Jacob. I remember that number, 844-24-JACOB. And here's the thing about Jacob. It doesn't matter what the case is. It could be you as a pedestrian. It could be you and an Uber or Lyft. It could be you and a company van or a company truck. Whatever this stuff is, they all come with their unique set of circumstances. And trust me, Jacob has dealt with every single one of them. Remember, accident, injury, there's only one guy you want. Jacob, Jacob, Jacob. 844-24-JACOB. That's 844-24-JACOB. 844-24-JACOB. Or remember...
Accident. Or injury, call Jacob and Ronnie, call Jacob.
Call Jacob.com, Mason, Ireland, 710 ESPN.
The black and gold dominated in their league's cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Gunnerstein, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bawanga versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL Tuesday night.
Pre-game begins at 7 p.m.
on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
Hit it, Jack.
Okay. Ooh, this is financial.
Oh, financial.
Okay. If you had to put all of your money into a single asset, which one would you choose? So you can put it all into real estate. You can put it all into crypto. You can put it all into the
stock market.
Right.
Or specific stocks.
NASDAQ. You put it. All right. Bergman, you've got $1 million. So you have to put it all in one place. Where's it going?
Probably Amazon.
Amazon stock?
Yep. Amazon stock.
It's not going anywhere, I'll tell you that.
It's not, it doesn't go up or
going,
down?
No, it's going up.
That's a blue chip.
They're buying everything. Yeah. They're buying all the streaming rights. They're buying.
They've Apple, got a ton Amazon of AI. Right. They've got a ton of cloud storage, right. All that
Where
kind
are they
going
to go? It's just going to get better.
Yeah. So. Right.
I think I would go Apple. Ahead of Amazon
stock.
Because they reinvent all the time. And Bezos, to me, even though I think Amazon is the best, most successful company in the world right now, and it's just raking in money.
Yeah.
I think almost everybody owns something Apple.
Yeah, I think so. Slee doesn't, right? Slee, I think, owns.
Brian, where would you put all your money?
Pixel.
I would say some sort of company that is, like, developing artificial intelligence.
Oh, yeah.
I put my money in, like, the AI kind of side of things.
Yeah, there's a stock called NVIDIA that's really good for that. Good for AI.
Yeah, that's,
NVIDIA?
Like, the next thing coming. Mace, how about you? Where you get all your money, but it's got to go one place.
I live in Los Angeles, California. It is real estate. The answer is real estate. It is super hard to buy a house, and, I'd probably try to... I don't know, flip one or do whatever people
right.
are doing in my neighborhood. But real estate,
solid.
I don't think you can go wrong.
Yeah.
In California, it just keeps going up.
It's interesting. This is code. We're asking, like, what's going to be the next thing?
Yeah.
Like what we're investing in. Did you guys see this story? I think I sent it to you guys this morning. Did you guys see this story that Zoom is making their employees come back into the office?
Right.
Isn't Zoom invented so you don't have to go into the office?
No. It is for other people, but it's not for Zoom. I can tell you that, for example, people are now being called back to the office all over the place. My brother, who works in advertising, didn't go to the office for 2 years, and now he's required to be at the office 3 days a week. I just think people do better work when they are in the same communal space. Nobody's like wandering off for coffee or Googling porn or any of that other stuff because they're at the office and they're working.
I don't dispute that. I think you're right. But what seems weird is that it's Zoom that's asking their employees to do this.
Yeah, no, it's true.
Zoom is a success because it got everybody through the pandemic. It allowed us to have meetings. Bergman, you were on a Zoom meeting this morning.
Right, but I was at a Zoom meeting this morning from the office.
Right.
So I wasn't at home.
But you could have been.
I could have been, but I'm here. I use Zoom every day from the office.
Right. But we all are in agreement on this show, on Mason and Ireland, that we like coming in here. We think the show is better. But Sedano and Cap don't come in every day.
Well, Sedano comes in 4 of the 5 days mostly.
Does he? Yeah. Okay.
Right. But I mean,
Cap does a bunch from San Diego because he's from, or South LA.
South LA.
Yeah. Right. But it's, I don't notice a drop off in their show when they do that. But the Zoom, if I ran Zoom, I was a head guy at Zoom, I would feel weird about insisting that people come in to work on Zoom. You know what I mean?
I see what you're saying. It's a, is it a conundrum?
Yes.
Wrapped in a riddle?
Is it a conundrum wrapped in a riddle?
Now, I guess to your point,
tucked into a
just because
cookie.
I work at Zoom doesn't mean I'm above working in an office.
Right, sure.
Yeah, but it just... trying to think of what it would be almost like if you ran Uber and Uber sent out a memo says, okay, you guys got to take a taxi 3 days a week.
Right. You can't take an Uber.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I'm like, why?
Yeah.
It seems weird.
In a related Zoom story, because I spent a lot of time on Zoom, Culture Pop Podcast. By the way, Max Bornstein, who is the executive producer, writer, and showrunner for Winning Time, is on there right now. You can search our YouTube channel, go to Culture Pop Podcast on YouTube, or get it Spotify and Apple. This is weird. In section, Zoom released new terms of service.
Okay.
Okay. Now tell me if you see a problem here. In section 10.4 of Zoom's Terms of Service, updated in March, Users agree to grant Zoom a perpetual, worldwide, non-exclusive, royalty-free, sub-licensable, and transferable license for various purposes, including machine learning, AI, training, testing, improvement, services, software, Zoom's other product services area. So you are, by using Zoom, granting them...
Your name, image, and likeness.
Name, image, and likeness.
Interesting.
Now, is this not super creepy?
Yes.
It's exactly what the writer strike or the actor strike is about. It's about scanning you and then sticking you in other stuff. Zoom apparently has the right to scan you while you're doing a Zoom call and then stick it in whatever Zoom call they want.
Yeah, very odd.
It's strange.
So I was doing the Blue Review this morning with Clinton Yates. First time I've done it in over a week. So it was nice.
Oh, nice.
But he was talking about how we're not going to use Zoom anymore because of this. This exact thing that's maybe...
Oh, he's going to quit using Zoom?
No, we're going to use something else. We're going to use like StreamYard or something else that instead...
Microsoft Teams or...
Specifically because of this?
Specifically because of the AI.
That they're taking ownership of it.
Yeah.
That Zoom's taking ownership.
Brian,
makes
are you
sense.
Afraid of Zoom now?
Oh, yeah. I was already didn't like Zoom, but the whole AI thing, that's what I'm saying. Like, this is taking over.
Yeah,
that's,
the AI
this
thing is
crazy.
Yeah.
That they could just do that. It's kind of like the South Park... episode with the whole iTunes where you just agree to the terms and then it's something like real crazy kind of a deal.
There is a
Don't
great
to bring a tile.
There's a great documentary called Terms and Conditions. Have you ever watched it?
No.
It is so good. I don't know what platform it's streaming on, but it's about, you know, every time you log on to anything, you click on accept, and it's a documentary about all
what
the
you're
stuff
accepting.
We're actually accepting. And the fact that nobody... Have you ever gone back to read one of those before you accepted?
No.
No.
Never.
You just
not.
Accept and move on. But what we're accepting at times is like this Zoom thing, granting your in perpetuity image, name, and likeness for Zoom to use anyhow they want. You got to watch that. All right, so Jared Goff. I'm a Jared Goff fan.
Mm-hmm.
I am in on the Lions this year. If the Rams don't fire, I'm going to follow the Lions this year. And famously, the Rams were involved in the 2018 NFC Championship game. And it was late in the game, and Jared Goff threw a pass Drew Brees threw a pass to Tommy Lee Jones.
They were driving. Saints were driving. Rams were up three.
Right. And there was an egregious pass interference call. Nickell Robey Coleman laid Tommy Lee Lewis out on a Waffle House frying pan, as has come to be said. And Jared Goff was asked this week if he owes an apology to Saints fans.
Will you ever apologize for the Saints game?
To who?
The Saints fans.
No, God,
okay,
no.
Okay.
No. They got the ball in overtime. They had a chance to win it.
There we go. I like that.
Was that pass interference?
No, it wasn't.
That's going to piss so many people off.
Was it called pass?
It was not. It was not called pass interference.
I've had a million pass interferences that weren't called. Who says he makes the field goal, too? I know he's like automatic from there. Lutz was, but I don't know. I mean,
yeah. They asked Jordan, like, did you push off against the Jazz game six? He's like, did they call it?
Yeah, right. Did they call it? No.
No.
It
was
not, I thought Roby's response was fantastic after the game, though, when they asked him, and he was like, yeah, it was. It's like, Rob, don't say that, Rob. But
that was there ever a moment during that 2-week stretch? Because I remember, like, Saints fans were like trying to petition, they were trying to take the like Supreme Court. Yeah. You're like, are they going to actually figure out a way to play this game again?
No. Yeah, they wanted to restart it from that play.
Yes.
No, they had that happened, and then they ended up throwing the ball again. They could have ran it and ran off more clock. They threw an incompletion, and then, you know, we got lucky. They turned it over to us in overtime, and we made a field goal from 60 yards. It wasn't like it was perfect for us either.
Obviously, I smacked his ass. You feel me? Put that boy on a Waffle House frying pan.
That's right, Nickell Robey Coleman.
By the way, I agree with Jared Goff. Oh. Bad calls are part of sports.
Yeah, I'm sure he's had 1,000 non-calls on pass interference.
It's never a good look. You know what taught me this, Bergman? It's never a good look if you just whine about calls that don't get made. I whined about the Tuck rule until I was... like,
you still whine when it comes up.
Well, it's a whinable offense.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Let it go, dude.
No. Right. Nobody nobody cares.
Yeah.
You know, you lost. Deal with it.
I don't know if I've ever actually heard that response.
Oh,
that's
really?
Got to be the funniest response.
No, it's the greatest. You know what he did?
That's great.
Okay, so you know what he did? They played that game. It was in New Orleans. Greg Zuerlein kicks a 60-yard field goal to send the Rams to the Super Bowl. I think they partied all the way home on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
And Nickell Robey Coleman did that on Instagram Live
yes.
from his house at like midnight.
Yep.
Oh, that clip wasn't even like a reporter or anything?
No,
wow,
no.
That's crazy.
That was just at home doing IG
And you could tell he had
Live.
been cocktailing. And matter of fact, I don't know if you can find it, Greg, but the next year at Rams Media Day, I declared that as the greatest soundbite in the history of sports soundbites. I can't remember who did it. I think it might have been Carlo. Went to Nickell Robey Coleman and said, John Ireland's quote, your quote is his favorite thing. He goes, John, I got one for you. And he did one in honor of me.
Yep.
Because I'm laid that boy out on a Waffle House frying
pan.
That's
so great.
Yeah,
it was very funny.
Excellent.
I have a couple of things here. I don't know. I can't hear him, though. I'm just going to play
him. Oh, let's try him.
Yeah, just play him.
Is still a great quarterback.
All right. We're going to get straight to the point.
No, that's the same one. Just the same one.
Yeah,
same
but to me, it was the
greatest.
Somewhere
in the archives.
Where is he now? Where is Nickell? Tennessee?
I don't know.
Hey, somewhere.
I don't know. I lost
Maybe he's on the Saints.
Nickell Robey.
Yeah, wouldn't that be funny if he's on the Saints?
Yeah. Rams brought back Josh Johnson yesterday.
I like that.
Yeah. John Johnson brought him back.
Josh Johnson has been quarterback on like more than half of the teams in the NFL.
JJ3.
Yeah.
John Johnson. All right.
He's a free agent right now. He's not on anybody.
Okay.
Coming up next for you, we are going to do the 2 o'clock call of the day. Now, Greg Bergman, you'll be surprised at this, has become enchanted with the concept of the 2 o'clock
I don't believe
call
you.
Of the day.
So much. It's my favorite thing that we do on the show.
Boom! How do you like that one?
Exactly. So, and today, best call, Greg. Four-pack of tickets to go see LAFC tonight versus Real Salt Lake at BMO Stadium. So 877-710-ESPN. Anything that we've been talking about.
Or you can go off the board if you want.
Yeah, go off the board. But bring it hard, and we will take care of you with tickets tonight for LAFC. Mason Ireland, 710-ESPN.
The black and gold.
unlike any other. Yesterday, not only did we take like three calls, we also played some classic play-by-play, and I enjoyed it. I don't think Corporate Greg enjoyed it, but I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. That could be our new format. Calls and play-by-play highlights. Old play-by-play highlights. Let's do it. The 2 o'clock call of the day with Mason and Ireland on Swift 710.
Boom! How do you like that one?
What a fortunate moment we find ourselves in.
Yeah! Fortunate moment because it's 2 o'clock call of the daytime. And today, if you're a great call, we will set you up with a four-pack of tickets to see LAFC tonight versus Real Salt Lake over at BMO Stadium. Bergman says, take caller number one.
All right. So, and they say the name is Big Fella.
Hey, Big Fella, don't ask us how we're doing.
Hey, guys, how you doing?
What's that, Michael?
He just got hung up on.
That sounded like Michael.
No, you don't think it really was Michael, do you? Was that Big Fella?
Was Michael Big Fella? All I heard was Big Fella.
Did you hang up on Michael Thompson?
I hung up on the guy that said, how you doing?
How do you hang up on Michael Thompson?
I don't think that was Michael Thompson. That was Big Fella, iconic, beloved.
Michael's coming in Thursday.
That was Big Fella in Glendale.
Let's try Sean on line two. Sean, don't ask us how we're doing.
Hey, guys. The best concerts to go to, especially for tailgating, were Grateful Dead concerts and Jimmy Buffett. I went to over 50 Grateful Dead concerts, and you could go to all the shows because they play a different show every single night.
Right.
That's what was really cool about them. But at a Jimmy Buffett concert, we had the best tailgate. We went there in a Greyhound bus.
Sean, I went through a phase. My best friend growing up was a huge parrot head, and so I would go to those concerts. I've probably seen Jimmy Buffett in concert 5 or 6 times, and you are right. The parking lot is a giant party. Like, by the time the concert starts, that's just almost like the afterthought.
But I'm sure there's no partying before the shows, right?
Oh, lots of partying. What we did was we brought a Greyhound bus and 50 bags of sand and made a beach at Irvine Meadows parking lot and pulled out our beach chairs, put up a fake palm tree and a little porta bar and drinking margaritas sitting in the stand.
Wow, that's a great idea. Good for you, man. That sounds like a party.
Yeah, parrot heads are like a cult. They're like the Grateful Dead.
And
he's
Grateful
right.
Dead
Sean, you're right, man. Yeah, good call. Hey, do you want to give Sean Sean, you want to go to a soccer game?
You know what? I give it to someone else. I can't make it tonight.
Okay, right, man. Yeah, you got to be able to make it tonight, honest. But thank you very much for the phone call.
Try Gilbert in Montebello on line three.
Hey, Gilbert, what's up? Don't ask us how we're doing.
Hey, I want to give a quick shout-out to the Angels.
What are you talking about? They've lost 7 games in a row.
Since the trade deadline, and they've been doubled up in run differential, like 40 to 20.
Nice.
That's all but cementing Ohtani's coming to the Dodgers next season, baby.
Oh! I like that angle.
I wondered where you were going with that,
yeah.
Gilbert.
They went for it and just crashed.
Yeah, that makes sense. By the way, I give them credit for going for it. It wasn't the smartest thing. It was the reckless thing. It was the gambler thing. It was the flip of a coin thing. It was the roll of the dice thing. But in the end, it was worth a shot, wasn't it? As late as it got, wasn't it worth a shot to go for it?
Oh, yeah, with Ohtani?
Yeah.
I mean, you might as well.
Once you reach a certain point, you might as well go for it.
Yeah, I would have traded him a year ago, but once you got this close and he had the best month in the history of months, then yeah.
Bergman, do you agree? Do you give the Angels any credit for doing what they did and going all in when they could have traded away?
I said it yesterday. I would have, because of what Perry Minasian did at this deadline and really going for it, he should have complete control of it next year.
So you like what he did?
I do. I thought he did exactly what he should have. Like, people, we were upset that we didn't get Lucas Giolito.
Yeah, we were.
And it was the right move for them to go out and get somebody. And I forgot who the other guy they went out and got, too, was.
They got that reliever also from the White Sox.
Right. Ronaldo Lopez.
And they got C.J. Crohn.
And they got C.J. Crohn, which also was a good move for them to go out and get him. They did the right things.
Right. And then they've just been
terrible.
Yeah. It just didn't break their work. Let's take one more call. Let's do the 206 call of the day. Let's go. Oh, okay. Let's do this. Dave and Agora, you're on 710. Don't ask us how we're doing.
Hey, guys. Well, my daughter, I haven't made it to SoFi yet, but my daughter went to 2 Taylor Swift shows, and she was underwhelmed with a couple things about SoFi. The food, as they say, she was there early, At 6 o'clock, she went to get food. The line was super long. They were already out of meatballs and salad, so she got the pizza. She said it took forever. She goes to the restroom to go, you know, go to the bathroom.
Yep.
And there's only a soap dispenser in every third sink.
Oh.
Who designs a billion-dollar stadium and can't put a soap dispenser in every sink?
You know Dave, you know what you should do? You should go listen to Mason's Culture Pop podcast with Kevin Demoff. He covers this, and he basically explains they had to open the stadium during COVID, and they weren't ready.
He lost it.
All right, well, I think we
okay, we lost him.
And they weren't. Kevin does a good job on your podcast of explaining this.
Yeah,
they
he
weren't,
does.
They weren't ready, but they opened it, and then they kind of figured out, okay, we can get by with this many people.
Right.
And now that it's been like Taylor Swift's packing 75,000 people in every night, they need to ramp it back up. And he says they're working towards
that. Yeah, and that, by the way, is more than a football game would have because you've got the entire field. I wonder what the capacity was last night. Had to be 80,000, right? Well,
they've been saying 75. But
75, yeah, it might be. 5,000 people on the floor of the stadium, that might be.
What is it for football, do you know?
No. No, I don't actually. Everybody was asking me the capacity of things last night. My friend Sarah was asking me the capacity. Like, what's the capacity at Staples?
It depends what the event is, but roughly 19,000.
19,000, okay. What's the capacity of the Forum?
17,505.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah. Well, it was back in the day. I don't know if it is now.
17,505 is right, yeah.
Yeah. Chick used to say that all the time. Sold out, 17,505 here at the Fabulous Forum. You know, yeah. Blah, blah, blah.
Trying to think, what's the Hollywood Bowl's capacity?
Crypto is 20,000.
Hollywood.
For basketball?
For basketball and 19,000 for hockey.
Yeah, Hollywood Bowl is 17,500. Mm-hmm. So there are a bunch of venues that are sort of about the same. For a big venue, this is obviously the place. For a big venue, I think SoFi is fantastic. The Oculus was all going and all that stuff. It was a great, great show. She brought gigantic screens. It was really loud.
I don't think they call it the Oculus anymore.
Oh, you're right. They call it the Infinity Board.
Yeah.
The Infinity
Oculus Board. Oculus didn't pay the bills.
It's sponsored by Infinity. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they own the rights to that. It's interesting. If you were to rank the places to see a concert in LA, I would say it goes Hollywood Bowl, Forum. Do you disagree with that? A concert. Hollywood Bowl, one. Forum, two.
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. No,
the Forum is great. Have you been to the Forum, Bergman?
Yeah, I went to the Forum when I was a kid.
No,
I saw the Gorillaz there.
Since they redid it.
Yeah, I saw the Gorillaz there. It was amazing.
The audio is just like perfect.
Hey, take that call on line six from Roger in North Hollywood.
Roger, don't ask us how we're doing.
What do you got, Roger?
What's going on, guys? I just want to ask you guys, Hollywood Bowl, perfect for concerts. I graduated there. It's awesome. I went to Hollywood High, so I graduated there.
That must be really cool to have your graduation at the Hollywood Bowl. That is cool.
It is awesome. I just want to ask you guys, who in major sports would you want to see throwing blows like the Anderson and Ramirez fight?
All right.
Like all major sports.
So yeah, in the NBA, there are two players.
Hey, Roger, we're going to give you a four-pack of tickets to see LAFC tonight versus Real Salt Lake at BMO Stadium.
Okay, so there are two players in the NBA nobody wants to fight. You know who they are?
Dylan Brooks?
No. One is
they will fight Dylan Brooks?
One is James Johnson, who actually is an MMA fighter who's 21-0.
Oh, wow, okay.
He's the number one guy nobody wants to fight. He's been with seven or eight teams. He's a professional fighter.
He's just an enforcer.
His dad was a professional fighter.
Okay.
Nobody messes with him. The other one is Steven Adams of the Grizzlies. He's from New Zealand. He's one of 18 brothers and sisters.
Oh, so he had to fight.
And the smallest kid is like 6'8".
Really?
Yeah. And the girls, the smallest one's like 6'4".
Wow.
His sister is an Olympic shot putter. So nobody wants to fight him either.
Yeah, yeah.
If those two had to fight each other, it would be steel cage.
Well, it sounds like
fight to the death.
It sounds like the MMA fighter would win that thing. I would think. What about football? Do we have? I'd like to see a couple of pretty boys go at it. How about a couple of quarterbacks? Quarterbacks go at it. Aaron Rodgers and
Aaron Rodgers isn't a fighter.
Jimmy G.
Aaron Rodgers and Jimmy G.
No, you need.
No, you can't touch the face. Don't touch the face. Those are the moneymakers.
You need guys who's. I'm trying to think of who's like a big guy. Like, you remember Dante Culpepper used to be like an oversized quarterback. There really aren't those guys anymore.
No.
What about two little guys like Kyler Murray and.
Oh, and little like guys.
Stroud and Tua? Yeah.
Kyler Murray and Tua?
Or Bryce Young.
Right. There we go.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, that's good. That's good.
Yeah, there aren't really any big, like, Cam Newton-sized quarterbacks anymore.
Doesn't happen anymore. Doesn't happen
anymore. That's kind of weird.
Yeah, it is. It is. All right, coming up next for you, Bergman is going to explain to us why the MVP race is really, really closer than I've been thinking. That's coming up next. In the meantime, it is a Hollywood Park Casino Fantasy Monday on 710. That's not the right thing. Let me try this again. Do you have a fantasy league draft that you want to be part of at the Ultimate Fantasy Football Draft at Hollywood Park Casino Friday, August 18th with the 710 crew? Register now, ESPNLA.com. Be with us for a fantasy party, Hollywood Park Casino. Eat and drink and draft. Mason and Ireland, 710 ESPN.
The biggest show on the radio, the most downloaded sports radio show in Los Angeles. Let's continue. Mason in Ireland, right now on Swift 710.
So last night I got to go to the Taylor Swift concert. Really, really good. She puts on a great show. If your daughter looks up to Taylor Swift, I think that's actually a good thing because she's so golly gee and she fancy walks all over the stage. She won't let this thing go about her scarf with Jake Gyllenhaal. She won't let stuff go with John Mayer, who she said, please don't pick on him, because she re-released the song Dear John, which was apparently very critical of her. But all in all, great time. Went till 11:45 last night. Went on at 8:15.
Which has been what she's doing.
Yeah, and I guess that's what she's trying to. She wants to be Bruce Springsteen, right? She wants to put on that level
there.
Of show.
Yeah, she's already there.
I'll tell you what. I don't do my best work after midnight anymore.
well, she doesn't either.
No.
They shut her off.
They cut her off, yeah.
Right before midnight.
All right, if you want to win a chance to play golf with John Ireland at Corporate Greg, Terranea Resort and ESPN LA, giving away a round of golf at the links at Terranea and lunch with Ireland and Corporate Greg, all you got to do is post a video of your golf swing on Instagram or Twitter and tag at ESPN Los Angeles. We will review the best swings, and you could be playing golf with Ireland and Corporate Greg at the links at Terranea. All right, so we've talked a little bit. I've been saying slam dunk MVP National League is Ronald Acuna Jr., best player on the best team.
I think you're right. Now, you think you're having second thoughts about this?
Well, Bergman made a pretty compelling case earlier this morning in our show meeting. Greg, you think it's much closer than I do.
Yeah, no, it is much, much closer than you think it is. So it's kind of crazy. Between Ronald Acuna Jr. and Ronald Acuna Jr. and Freddie Freeman, it is percentage points away in basically everything. So Freddie Freeman's played one more game, has four more at-bats based off of that one more game. They are tied in runs scored. Freddie has more hits, but not by two. He has two more hits than him. Freddie has 12 more doubles. They have the same amount of triples. Ronald Acuna Jr. has two more home runs. Freddie's leading in RBIs, but the percentage points are minuscule when it comes to average on-base percentage, slugging percentage, OPS.
The separator is steals, right?
Separator steals. Ronald Acuna has 53-19 for Freddie Freeman, or 16 for Freddie Freeman, which is still a large number for a first baseman.
Sure.
Let me ask you guys this. If Freeman wins the batting title, does that swing it his way?
It's right there. I mean, especially if he's a gold glove, too.
It's going to be very, very close between the two of them. But I think the stolen bases and playing for the best team is what lifts Acuna. But Freddie is having just an unbelievable year.
It's below a .10. What is that? .01. What is that? A tenth of a percentage point for everything.
Yeah, leads the league in doubles. Leads the league in OPS, 10-12. Yep.
And it's not by much, though. Ronald Acuna Jr. has a .1.003, which is only .9.
Yeah, I think in the end, don't you think best player, best team tends to be who wins the MVP?
Well, Otani's going to win in the AL, and he is not. But if you look at the stats, they're right on top of each other. Everything is just like two or three away. It's pretty intense.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a lot closer. All I'm saying is it's a lot closer than what we think it is.
What are the odds in Vegas? I like asking questions that you clearly don't
I was
know the
did
answer
not have that ready.
Come on, I thought you 25%
to 19%.
Nice.
I have no idea.
25% to 19%, says Bergman.
Says the Bergman Law Group.
John, this guy reminds me of me. His name is Kevin Ford. He's a cook and cashier at the Burger King at the Las Vegas McCarran International Airport.
Well, he reminds me of you too, if he's a fast food guy at a restaurant.
Yeah. He's worked there for 27 years and has never missed a day. 27 years.
So how does that compare to you?
Because I'm a grinder too, man. I get in here.
You're the opposite of a grinder. I'm surprised, frankly, you're here today.
Yeah.
I thought you were setting up to take today off.
No.
Because you were going to the concert, and I figured he's going to be too exhausted. Bergman, didn't you think if Mason went to that concert, it was 50-50 if we had him today?
I thought there was zero chance you were here.
Did you really?
I almost had somebody on backup.
I did.
There was zero chance I was going to miss.
I almost called you and said, hey, if Mason goes to this concert, have somebody on stage.
No, there was zero chance I was going to miss. Zero chance I was going to miss today. Zero.
Good for you.
Less than
good
zero.
Good for you.
Yeah. So anyway, guy Kevin Ford, like me, works every day. So when he celebrated his 27th year without missing a day of work, the Burger King gave him some gifts. It included candy and pens and other stuff it looks like the company had laying around. So a very nice gift.
So you know what?
27 years without a day off.
I've said this many, many times. I think you actually have figured out, like, my biggest flaw, really as a person, is my work-life balance.
Yes.
It's way out of whack.
Right.
You don't have that issue.
I do not.
At all. I think we're all going to look back and go, Yeah, sure, we all made fun of Mason for taking all the days off, but he got the days off.
Yeah, no, that's true. And back in the day, I did operate like you did. I did operate like, you know, I was running movie theaters at the same time I was writing about box office, at the same time I was doing the show every day. And I was working, basically, Juan says, I worked when I was awake. Well, that's not the case anymore. I spend a fair amount of the time not awake. Now, the story of Kevin Ford doesn't end, thankfully, John.
There's more?
One of his co-workers put out a video last summer on TikTok, and it went viral. And they said he's never missed a day of work. In the video, he showed the gifts the chain's hiring company gave to him as a reward. He also got a movie ticket and a Starbucks cup and a bag of Reese's candy.
7 years.
Two packets of Lifesavers, two pens, and two keychains.
Did somebody just go to the CVS?
Somebody went to the airport store and bought a bunch of stuff. So one of the somebody out there, one of his daughters, created a GoFundMe page in honor of her dad,
who had not missed a day of work in 27 years.
It has raised $400,000.
No kidding.
$400,000.
Hey, Bergman, why don't you set up a GoFundMe page for you?
I could use the $400,000.
I was going to say. Oh!
I'm in debt.
By the way, Bergman.
Yep.
I may have a girl for you. Did you see who's single?
Oh, no.
Oh, boy. Who is it?
Okay, first of all, she's in the tribe.
Okay.
Super attractive.
Okay.
And recently separated. Okay.
Recently separated. Okay. So rebound. Got it.
You could be. But when I tell you.
You are the rebound.
When I tell you who it is, you're going to want to be like Dennis Rodman. You're going to be all over these rebounds.
It's Carmen Electra?
Better.
Okay.
It's Natalie Portman.
Oh, no.
Oh, I did know that, actually. Sedona would kill me if that happened.
Oh, Natalie
Portman. No, Sedona's married.
No, I understand, but that's his girl.
Yeah, but Sonata, Kelly's awesome, his wife.
No, Kelly's amazing.
He would, Sonata would fully support you and Natalie Portman, as would I.
I would support me and Natalie Portman.
Exactly.
That'd
so
be
get
amazing.
To stepping. Come on.
I'm also not a billionaire like her ex-wife, ex-husband.
But oh, so, was he a billionaire?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, was he really?
Maybe she wants something different now, though, you know?
No, yeah. Wants the 100 air.
Yeah. Now, I'll say this about Natalie.
I think he was.
What's the first thing you think of when you think of Natalie Portman?
The Professional.
Great movie. She was a little kid. She was brilliant.
Amazing in that
movie. Yeah, amazing.
Her and Benjamin Millipede.
I guess the first line of her bio is going to be Star Wars. But I think she's been great in a bunch of other stuff.
So,
like, she's great in Black Swan. She was great in what's that movie she does with Ashton Kutcher where they're just friends and they start sleeping together? That's a
friends
good movie.
Friends with Benefits?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's... There's one with Mila Kunis and Justin Timberlake, and there's one with Ashton Kutcher.
No, one's No Strings Attached. And
that
one is,
No Strings Attached is the Natalie Portman.
Yeah.
And the other one is Mila Kunis.
Right. Did you ever have Friends with Benefits?
No.
You never had that relationship?
But yes. I'm not giving up, you know.
Yeah.
Bergman,
did you ever have Friends with Benefits?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And
me
great.
Too. I always thought it was nice. It was reassuring.
It was, because then you could just be like, all right, well,
hey,
thanks.
You, come on over. I got the night free.
It was fun. You can go
Let's
home.
Let's have some fun. Now,
or
see
I'll
you later.
Go home.
Yeah,
whatever,
we're not
you know,
in. We're,
road games.
We're not. There's no emotional connection
no,
here. Just physical.
And then you just like hang out afterwards. You watch like a show or something.
Yeah.
Like, all right, well, see you
yeah,
later.
Yeah, I think
you missed out.
I may have this backwards, but I'm pretty sure Friends with Benefits was Timberlake and Mila Kunis. And No Strings Attached was Natalie Portman and Ashton Kutcher.
That's
same
right.
exact premise.
There is your rom-com update for
yeah.
today.
Both movies? Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, both.
Liked
both
them
movies.
Both.
Exactly. All right, coming up next for you, let's Broncos head coach Sean Payton.
Okay, I'm so glad we're going to bring this up. I don't understand what his issue is.
No, I
other
don't
than
either.
The fact that he's extremely outdated.
Yes.
But we'll get into it next.
Mason, Ireland, 710 ESPN.
710.
Yeah, Taylor did all kinds of fancy walking last night over at the SoFi Stadium, and she's got two more nights. So hurry up. Sarah, who I went to the concert, I went with a couple of like true hardcore Swifties who gave me friendship bracelets and a ring like a snake for some reason. I don't fully understand why. But they're going to try to get in for Wednesday night. And buy just bad obstructed seats, which are still $800. Bad obstructed seats behind the stage.
Wow.
Now, you know
$800.
What, you know what I wanted? Because it was such a relax. I wanted like a hammock. I think they should have a section where there are like hammocks.
Hammocks are very underrated.
Right. Don't you think?
Had one in my college dorm room for all the whole time I was there.
I think a hammock, watching the concert from a hammock or a lawn chair or whatever, but there was no sitting. Tell you what, there's no sitting at a Taylor Swift concert.
Right.
Everybody's on their feet. So Broncos coach Sean Payton, who's coming on like a hard ass. You don't get your special coaches, Russell Wilson. You don't get your office in the building. All this kind of stuff he's doing. Now, he's taking a weird target right now. He does not like what he calls Gilligan hats, but are actually bucket hats.
And I'm not... Okay, so number one, I don't know what he has against bucket hats.
Yeah,
bucket hats are great.
Bucket
hats
are awesome.
I was watching that Team USA Puerto Rico basketball game last night.
Okay.
And... there was Draymond Green and I think it was Chris Paul sitting there, and they're both wearing bucket hats.
Bucket hats are great.
Bucket hat, and they're also very big in the African American community. I don't think Sean Payton did his homework on this.
I think, but yeah, in fact,
Lindsay, I would wear a bucket hat right now if I had one.
Lindsay wore a bucket
Lindsay
hat.
Lindsay loves
to,
them.
What is Sean Payton's issue with, as he puts it, Gilligan hats?
He's just like a follow my rules guy. Yeah. Follow my rules. No bucket hats.
Yeah, but what? What's the point? That's like saying no. So does he have a problem with
baseball? He thinks they look sloppy.
Does he have a problem with baseball hats?
No, because baseball hats are kind of a...
How about if I turn my baseball hat around backwards?
That's uncool. That is so 1991.
What about a Kangol hat?
What is a Kangol hat?
Like what Sam Jackson always wears.
Like Sam Jackson. Sue Kalinske also wears one, a Kangol hat.
Just Google it. K-A-N-G-O-L. You probably own one.
Now, those you're supposed to wear backwards, I think.
Well, you can wear them any way you want.
Yeah, I see a lot of people wearing them backwards. Yeah, those hats.
Why is Sean Payton anti-hat?
I'm rooting. I hope Juan's not out driving around. But I'm kind of rooting for another Russell Wilson implosion. That's right. That's right. Do you think that's going to work?
I think they'll be improved.
I talked to Kirk Morrison on Saturday
I think that division goes. Chiefs win it.
Yeah.
Chargers double-digit wins and make the playoffs.
Okay.
Broncos probably 8-9, 9-8.
Yeah.
Raiders hopefully 2-15.
0-17.
So we get Caleb.
Yeah. 6-11.
0-17.
6-11 would be just brutal.
6-11.
6-11 would be horrible season. No Caleb.
Yeah.
I want Caleb Williams.
Yeah, I understand why. I understand why. Has anybody left the Pac-12 today, or are we still at two?
I think Washington State's on their way out.
Washington State is about ready to go to the Mountain West.
They're going to the WAC.
So,
Oregon State in the WAC.
So
Washington State in the Mountain West.
Right.
The great Bruce Feldman had a really good point.
Uh-huh.
He said, if you're one of the remaining if you're one of the remaining teams in the what used to be the Pac-12.
There are only two.
Okay. And you know, everybody's telling the Pac-12, well, go get the Mountain West and just bring them all to the Pac-12. If I'm in the Mountain West, I don't want to go to the Pac-12. The Pac-12 is run by a bunch of boobs.
Although it all depends on exactly how much the TV deal. Like, I can't imagine the Mountain West TV deal is
very
much.
Would you want to go to... I mean, this guy Klevikoff doesn't know what he's doing.
Well, it comes down to one simple question. I guess Fresno State would be in the Mountain West, UNLV.
Yeah.
Can I make more money in the Pac-12? That's the question.
This is the old... You know who Don Olmeyer is?
Oh, sure.
Okay, so Don Olmeyer had a saying that I always remember. No matter what we're talking about, okay, so we're going to have a conversation on any subject.
Right.
The answer, this is an Olmeyer line, the answer to all of your questions is money. You just did that there.
You said,
you know what? they'll go to the Pac-12 if they can get paid.
Sure, sure. Now, I've never been a believer that everything is only for money.
Well, yeah, it was in this story.
In this
though.
Story, it yeah. absolutely
That's
is.
Why the Pac-12
USC,
has crumbled.
USC, UCLA to the Big yeah, Ten,
they
it's all
just
about money.
Went.
But I don't think that everybody makes determinations exclusively on money. I think
Well,
you,
they did in this case.
Yeah, in this case. But you believe in money as the end solution more
in
than
sports.
I do.
In sports. So if you ask, you know, why did somebody make that terrible trade? Well, they're trying to drive their TV money
sure,
bigger.
Sure.
You know, or why did somebody in this case, why would UCLA and USC agree to leave the Pac-12 to go
right.
send their softball team to Rutgers? Money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think there are exceptions. I mean, that
sure.
Mbappe did not take the Saudi money.
Right.
And did not go to play in
but
the live,
Saudi,
whatever
the
that
Saudi
is.
The Saudi money thing is really interesting to me because it really depends on how strongly you feel about this whole sports washing thing.
And I feel very strongly about it.
Except you drive a gas-powered car. You don't, you don't have to.
It's not even down to that, John.
No, but you
I
don't
mean,
have
to. Do you really want me to go here? Cause
yeah. But I mean, it's you. If you felt like super strongly about you didn't want to support any Saudi Arabia, we get all our gas from
right.
there.
But they also do as many as 30 public beheadings in streets
right.
in
so
Saudi Arabia every day.
Totally understand, and totally understand why
I
you feel the way you do about sports.
I think
sports,
everybody should just have to watch one. Just watch one
okay.
and see if you want to take that money.
So why don't you have an electric car?
Because I can't.
Why?
Because I've nowhere to plug in.
So you call an I looked into it. I almost did it. You call an electrician.
Yeah.
You pay him $5,000 and he puts it in your garage.
Yeah.
And you're set for the rest of your life.
I can never support a country where gay guys get their heads cut off.
Right.
Done.
Right. But except when it comes to cars.
Our economies are completely intermingled. There's no way to separate economies. There is a way to say,
okay,
your human rights are not,
correct.
Don't match my values.
Correct. But if our economies are intermingled.
And they are.
Why can't the golfers take advantage of this?
Because this is literally what sports washing is. Literally what it
correct.
Is.
Correct.
It is covering up the stuff I was talking that I don't know, but I mean
right.
that's how I really feel and why I feel it.
Right, but I'm saying if you felt as strongly as it appears you do, I don't get why you fall back on our economies are intermingled, because once you do that, then why don't the golfers get to use the same line?
They do. You just have to make a determination. I just
right.
think
so
everyone should have to watch one.
Right. You feel strongly about the, like, if you were a golfer and you are a live guy, or they asked you to be a live guy, you wouldn't do it.
Correct.
But when it comes
I'd be like Mbappe.
Right. But when it comes to cars, you're okay with giving them your money.
Correct.
Yeah.
I am.
So it's weird. I mean, to me, that's conflicting ideologies. But.
And by the way, we only get 7% of our oil from OPEC.
Right.
So it's not. It's
but
not
they
like,
would get 0% if you bought a Tesla.
Did you realize that? We only get 7% of our oil from
yeah,
the Persian Gulf.
Right. But most of all that OPEC money oil is coming from Saudi Arabia.
Right.
So it just depends. I agree with you, actually, on most of this stuff. But if you're gonna fall back on, I can't get an electric car because the economies are in a mingle.
Now, I'll say this. I will never go to the Middle East. I will never go to Dubai or any Saudi Arabia or Riyadh.
What if the Olympics were there and they asked you to host the Olympics?
Wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Just wouldn't do it.
Yeah, so it's weird that you feel that strongly, but you still put gas in your
yeah,
car.
It's weird that you're okay with it, even though guys get their heads cut off every day.
But
literally on the street.
But what I would say is what you said, that I don't support that, obviously. But if our economies, if we're in a world economy,
and we are.
And we're going to.
We don't survive without China. China doesn't
correct.
Survive without us.
Correct.
Right.
So if that's your position, and you're going to participate in a world economy, then it's hard to take a human's right position, because if you really didn't want to, support Saudi Arabia, you could do more.
They only give us 7% of our gas. It's not like we're keeping Saudi Arabia afloat. They've got so much friggin' money, they can buy anything.
Which is the heart of the problem.
They're going to buy NFL teams. They're going to buy Major League Baseball teams. They're going to buy NBA teams.
Do you really believe that?
I do.
I don't think the NFL needs them.
Oh, no. I mean, once somebody comes to them with $10 billion for a team, somebody will sell.
I think it's already happened.
And by the way, $30 million for it, $30 billion.
But
for
team. I think somebody tried to come to buy the Commanders for $10 billion, and they said no.
Did they?
That's what Roger Goodell said. He said we've had interest, but at this point we're not there yet.
Yeah, I just think they have so much. You know, here's $100 billion.
Yeah, nothing you've said is wrong, but the problem is if you're going to participate in a world economy and you're going to fall back on that, then all of a sudden you open yourself up to a whole bunch of human rights positions.
Yeah, there's no way I'm ever visiting anywhere in the Middle East. It is the most inhumane part of the world. All right. Coming up next for you, going to do some What's Up, Fool. We will lighten things up considerably.
What's up, fool?
Wasn't planning on that being part of the show. Mason, Ireland, 710 ESPN.
What's up, Fool? And we've been very excited that What's Up, Fool is made possible by our friends at Dos Hombres. In fact, we've got a special guest voice. Take it away, guest voice.
What's Up, Fool is brought to you by Dos Hombres Mezcal. It's fate. It's friendship. It's mezcal. Dos Hombres.
Look at that. How do I follow that? I don't. So I simply say, take it away, Corporate Greg.
Thanks, Morales. All right, so I'm going to start off this off today, and then Brian's going to go for a little bit, too.
Okay.
So the NBA refs are doing something I kind of like, actually. They have started something called hashtag NBRA Tuesday Talks, which stands for National Basketball Referees Association. They give two rules, and you vote on which one you want explained. So let's try and get one of the rules for next Tuesday. What rule would you like to understand more of in the NBA?
Well, the one that makes no sense is illegal defense.
Right, illegal defense, I'd love to see
them. They would just explain to you what illegal defense is.
Yeah, well, it's so subjective that half the time it makes no sense. I would just get rid of it.
So, like, today was, like, what a fumble is or a five-second back to the basket. So is there a rule that you guys would want to know more about or why, what the reasoning behind it is?
I don't know.
Is?
I feel like I've got a pretty, Ireland, and I know you have a handle on the rules. I feel like I have a handle on the rules. Is there something you don't understand, Bergman?
No, I just thought this would be a good question.
It is an interesting question.
Right.
So they're doing like some sort of seminar and they're saying this is
like it's on Twitter. So like you just go to the NBA referees and they're putting forward what they think they're giving you. So it's NBA referees at official NBA refs and they give two rules.
Right. And then they explain him.
And they explain the winner.
Is there anything that we don't know? Have you seen anything we don't know?
No. Okay. But I just see if there was a rule that you guys wanted. So this didn't work. That's fine. you guys know every rule, and every rule
it
is fine.
It didn't work, but that's okay.
I'm for fewer rules in general. So they're asking to explain more rules.
Like this one says, the results are in for fumble. Rule 4, section, 18. A player who is holding the ball and fumbles it out of his control may recover the ball. If his pivot foot moves to recover the ball, he must then pass or shoot the ball.
Boom! How do you like that one?
What's up, fool?
Don't take it too personal there,
Brian. Yeah. Brian, what do you got?
Very personal.
So I have a little niece who just started sixth grade, and she's going to be running for class president. And they gave her the choice. She has to come up with a speech, and she's running against somebody whose mom is the vice principal of the school.
Okay.
So she thinks she's already at a disadvantage.
Sure.
But if you were to, give her advice of sixth grade class, what are you putting in that speech to win?
Super PAC. You need to have a super PAC in order to win.
What you do is you go back and watch Napoleon Dynamite. They would say stuff like, I'm putting better food in all the vending machines. By the way, you could do the Andrew Yang thing. Give everybody $100. Andrew Yang wanted to give everybody $1,000.
Sure.
For a sixth grader, $100. Yeah, for Andrew to say, number one, I'm going to put good food in the vending machines, and I'm going to give everyone $100. And don't even explain it. Just step down right after you say that.
And candy.
Yeah, that's
can't go wrong with candy. So, when's this election coming up?
I'm not sure.
You're not sure?
Not sure. School just started, so it's got to be soon. Though.
So there's a campaign period.
There's a campaign period.
And then who is this? Who are we talking about?
My niece.
Your niece.
What's her name?
Aubrey.
Aubrey.
Aubrey. So do you want Mason and I to do endorsements for Aubrey?
Oh, there we yes.
Because Greg, talking. See if you can find these. Mason and I once did attack ads on each other.
Yeah.
And so we're very famous for, being in the political arena. If you want Aubrey to get an endorsement from the two of us, or what you need to do is give us, we're really good. Mason and I are both really good at attack ads. So find out this other sixth grader that Aubrey is running against. And Mason and I will attack.
Nothing like picking on a sixth grader.
Yeah. Jorge always got it off of YouTube, so we'll try and find it.
Okay.
What's up, fool?
I saw when we were talking about ice cream yesterday and all that good stuff. I saw this yesterday on my way home, and it kind of made me gag a little bit. The Salt and Straw ice cream shop in downtown Disney has a new flavor, chocolate potato salad.
Ugh.
It's a scoop of spiced mustard ice cream seasoned with paprika, dill, celery seed, and potato chip cookies.
Keep it simple, stupid.
No
this
wonder,
is insane.
Mace, was it you that said yesterday you had a story?
Ice cream sales are down
no
by 20%.
No wonder.
Yeah.
Potato salad ice cream? No thank
that
you.
That sounds horrible. And they make all kinds of weird flavors of ice cream. Like I saw one with, it was green and it had pieces of cricket in it. They called it cricket ice cream. I'm like, no, just keep it simple. Just give me a vanilla, give me a strawberry, give me a Neapolitan, give me a pistachio. That's all I need. I don't need potato salad in my ice cream.
Yeah, I don't need you to be seasoning my ice cream.
Yeah, that's
after
right.
The fact.
Right, exactly.
What's up, fool?
All right, so Arizona State AD Ray Anderson was talking to the media about the move to the Big 12 and said this in a press conference. I promise I'm not going to Morgantown. I'm going to sign that to Deputy AD John Boyd. He can go to Morgantown. But send me to Texas and the rivalry with Arizona and starting a new one with BYU, Utah, and Colorado. This feels like kind of a bad choice of words, no?
Well, he's passing the buck, but...
But he said straight out, I'm not going to Morgantown.
But you're willing to send your every sports team that you supposedly oversee to Morgantown?
Right.
Yeah, it's not a good look. You're right.
Yeah, no, I mean, dishonesty in college sports, I never heard of such a thing.
But it's not dishonesty. He's being honest. I'm not going to go to Morgantown. I won't go to West Virginia.
Right. Yeah, I won't go to West Virginia, but... Yeah,
not even but someone else is going.
Someone else is going to make the deal.
Have you ever heard an AD say something like this before? Like, I'm not going to Corvallis. I would never go
I've
to Corvallis.
I've actually heard a lot of people say I'm not going to Corvallis.
I tried for many years not to go to Corvallis.
But you went.
Pullman, and I'm not going to Corvallis.
Yeah, no.
What's up, fool?
Go ahead.
All right, so the NFL Hall of Fame just inducted some more people. So now there are first-time eligible players for the 2024 ballot.
Okay.
Which of these first-time people on the ballot do you think has a chance to get in during their first time?
Okay.
Julius Peppers, Antonio Gates, Eric Berry, Jamal Charles, Brandon Marshall, Adam Pac-Man Jones, Jordy Nelson, Doug Baldwin, and Andrew Luck.
What are the first two names were?
I think there's one name on that whole list who gets in first ballot. Antonio Gates.
Antonio Gates is
the only one I heard.
Yeah, I don't think anybody else.
I think Julius Peppers will get in, and I do think Andrew Luck will get in.
Not on the first ballot,
but they will get in.
Yeah, I was curious about that. You do think Luck does get in eventually?
I do. I think he did.
He retired at 30, right?
And walked away for good reasons because he felt like. Ultimately in the Hall of Fame. But, yeah, I agree. Antonio Gates was just a monster as a player.
What's up, Foo?
Yeah, I agree with that. Gates, first time Hall of Famer.
Of course you do.
Even got a Gates jersey.
I bet you've got a Gates jersey.
Beautiful.
Oh, God. Beautiful. We are going to go at it during football.
All right. So I saw this yesterday as well. In Australia, they're going to be testing out glow-in-the-dark highway markers so people can drive safer at night, better seeing. What do you think about adopting this here in, the U.S.?
Anything that leads to people driving more safe, I guess
yeah,
I'm
what
for.
Would be the downside to doing that?
Maybe some raves on the freeway or something. I don't know.
I don't think they're raving on the freeway necessarily unless it's like La La Land and everybody starts dancing when the traffic stops.
For my money, this is still the most incredible opening 5 minutes of a movie in the last 10 years is La La Land's opening scene.
It's right.
By the way, they shot all with one camera.
Right. And I think it's like right at the 10 and the 110.
Yeah. I don't know how they did it.
Yeah. It's great. Back to your question, I would say La La Land is a good explanation for what is in my head.
What's up, Foo?
All right, so there's a story out from where NASA's James Webb Telescope has spotted a giant question mark looking object in deep space. So I just sent it to you in the group chat. You can go check it out. It actually looks like a giant question mark, too. What do you think this could possibly be?
Oh, that's really crazy.
It's pretty crazy, right?
Yeah, that is crazy. I think it is a black hole.
You guys are just seeing things.
No, are you not seeing it?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. What are you not seeing? That's not a question mark. Right there. That's a question mark.
It's a question mark.
Don't dispute it. That is a question mark, 100%.
It's two blobs of light.
Yeah, I know, but they form a question mark.
So what do you think the question is they're asking?
Is anybody out there?
Yeah. It's like a smoke signal. They're putting these lights up to see if anybody responds.
Or it could just be two lights positioned to look like
What fun are you?
Yeah, I thought you liked conspiracy theories, and they're going to go, maybe it's just two lights.
No, I'm trying to think of what the question would be that goes with that question mark.
If you want to know what the representatives of the Space Telescope Science Institute
and
in Baltimore
thought. And I was just going to ask you.
They said it's probably a distant galaxy or potentially interacting galaxies.
Really?
Their interactions may have caused the distorted question mark shape.
And by the way, it is. Now look at the picture down below. It is so tiny you would never see it. It's only when it gets. Look.
Yeah.
Are you looking at this?
Yeah.
It's tiny. It's a tiny little thing.
Come on.
Yeah, I don't think it's a question mark.
It's a question mark. Within 1 minute.
No, the aliens are here. We just learned this like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah. Which one are you looking at? Because what I sent you, I don't see that.
Scroll down and you'll see how small it is.
You'll see the size
I like to think that it is Space Riddler.
All right. Space Riddler. I like
Space Riddler.
I like that one. That's a good
Bergman.
Yeah.
That's a good name for like a comic book.
Or a movie. Space Riddler.
You should you unlike Cody and you need to copyright Space Riddler.
Yeah.
Those knuckleheads forgot to copyright the blueprint
Space
and Pau Gasol stole the name of their podcast. Hurry up and copyright Space Riddler before Pau Gasol steals it.
It is an excellent idea, Space Riddler.
Space Riddler would be a great movie, and I think this actually is something. Like I think that it
By
is
the way, I think
mark.
Space Riddler is in the DC universe, is it not? Isn't it in the DC Riddler? Universe?
No, it's in the Marvel Universe.
No, DC. I'm talking about Space Riddler.
No, I'm wrong anyway. Asks, Riddler is in DC. Yeah.
How would they know our alphabet?
That is a very good point, Laura.
They're already here.
Technically, a question mark is not in the alphabet.
Well, it's punctuation.
Laura Romo.
Why did they
it's
know?
Punctuation.
Why did they know
it's not
our
in
punctuation?
The alphabet.
Yeah,
Laura
you know what
Romo.
You meant.
Yeah.
Why are you being a stickler?
Why rules. We live on a society of rules.
Yeah.
What's up, fool?
I don't think there's anything to that. All right.
There is something there.
Yeah.
Space right. Riddler.
I know you think.
What else,
I know you
what
think
else you guys got?
You got one more?
Yeah, I got one more for you.
Cool.
I saw this today, too. Love is Blind alum Nick Thompson says he is going to be homeless after being paid $10,000 for 10 weeks of filming with no residual pay. He says he can't get a job now because people won't take him seriously after being on the show.
Huh.
Would you take someone serious after being on one of these dating shows?
Okay, so, but here's the weird thing. Bergman, you're in a position now where you're hiring people.
Yes.
I watch all sorts of crap, and I don't even know what Love is Blind is.
Oh, Love is Blind is good. It's on Netflix.
One, yeah.
Is right, it good?
So yeah. Would you know this guy if he walked into your office?
I shouldn't admit it, but I've seen all four seasons, so probably.
All right, and would his appearance...
Nick Thompson.
Would his appearance on that show preclude you from hiring him for an open job if you had one?
Hmm.
It depends
how... Well, not in this industry. We have so many stories.
Don't you think it depends on how... What
like
happened
what he did.
While
was
he was on the
was
show?
Was he a bad guy?
Right. Was he a jerk to the female? Yeah. Or, yeah.
Did he not treat the dates right? I don't know. What is...
He was fine.
What's the premise of Love is Blind? You take people blindfolded and they all go in and they try to date a woman. What is it?
No, you go in...
That's a pitch, by the way. I'm pitching that.
Yeah, good job. So they have these pods and you go... So a man and a woman go to a pod. Uh-huh. You can't see each other.
Okay.
And you go on dates and there's like 10, 15 of each.
Well, how do I go on a date with someone I can't see?
Well, that's the whole point of it. So you sit there and you just talk through this wall and you can talk to each other and you have a date with each other, but you don't actually see each other. So you try and learn about the person that you fall in love with their personality.
Yeah.
And then
do
you
they
don't
ever,
actually...
Do they ever stay together?
Yes. I think there's one or two that have stayed together. But the only way you can actually see the other person is if you propose and accept.
Is there a special pod where you do it?
No. Not till afterwards when you go to Mexico.
Not at all. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no time
you,
for
well, because then after
I wouldn't
you
hold
do that,
it. I would not hold it against this guy.
No, I wouldn't hold it against
him. That he
you.
Went on a reality. Most people at this point have been on a reality show or two. So, yeah, no, I don't have nothing against. His name is Ronald.
Nick
Thompson.
Nick, Ronald, whatever.
Yeah,
good luck.
Same
good luck. I think you'll be fine.
What's up, fool?
I can do one more if you'd like.
Yeah,
go for it.
Sure, why not? All right, so Gary Phillips is a writer for the New York Daily News.
Uh-huh.
He learned something the other day, and it's something interesting from then-former Dodger and current Yankee Tommy Canley. He's a reliever for the Yankees.
Right.
He shaves his entire body every time he gives up a run. It's a punishment for him. Apparently, he wants to be hairy. So he shaves his entire body every time he gives up a run. First off, how did the story not come out when he was a Dodger? And what is right. Bill Plunkett doing? And is this and is this the weirdest superstition you've ever heard?
He shaves his entire body.
Entire body.
First of all, I would like to defend Bill Plunkett. His job is not to go in the shower and see who shaves where.
You can see if he's shaved. His arms are shaved. And then one day.
Weirdly, while Tommy Canley was here, every time Tommy Canley gave up a run, Bill Plunkett ate another donut.
Oh, that is just brutal.
My God.
Why would you do that? What in the world? That was such a cheap shot.
That was a cheap shot.
I love you, Bill. I love Bill.
What in the world?
Bill was such a good guy. Such
like
a nice
he wasn't
man.
Even sitting there. That was just something he wanted to do.
I was just looking for a gag there. And Bill Plunkett.
He decided donut was the way to go.
He got the shrapnel.
From the guy that orders donuts to his bed.
Yeah, exactly.
What's up, fool?
All right, that'll do it.
All right. How well did Andrew Friedman do at the trade deadline? I've got some pretty interesting numbers that show he did pretty, pretty good. That's coming up next. Mason in Ireland, 710 ESPN.
ESPN 710, Los Angeles. Sports.
And it is the biggest show on the radio. Mason and Ireland is on for your Tuesday afternoon.
Up your dukes here, kid.
Here we go. Happy Tuesday on Swift 710. That's right. The bit continues because it annoys everybody. I'm not even that big of a T-Swizzle person or a Swiftie. But we know I like a good bit that fires people up.
Swift 710.
Speaking of Swift 710, we will get the recap from Steve Mason looking good last night in that picture at SoFi Stadium in his Sunday Swagger polo, taking in a little T-Swizzle. We'll get all the details, plus all the other stuff going on. Johnny Eyes here, Corporate Greg, and yes, producer Brian Cohen on the wheels of steel. Let's get to it for a Tuesday afternoon.
Players going to play.
Exactly.
Haters going to hate.
Mason and Ireland on Swift 710 right now.
3 o'clock round. Last night, Taylor Swift at SoFi Stadium. Got to go there. Got to be
so
there.
Give us the 1 minute review. If you were reviewing the Taylor Swift concert from last night, she plays again tonight, right?
Plays again tonight.
And then
and
again
Wednesday.
Tomorrow night, and then she's done.
Correct.
All right. So your 1 minute review is what?
It is a great big spectacular show. Gigantic sets, really cool dancers. She fancy walks all over the place. She does every song that she's ever done. And the highlight, by the way, was the album 1989, which has what I call all the bangers. It's got Shake It Off. It's got this one, Blank Space, which was a big song. And she won all night. I mean, just amazing the stamina that she
has. She is a tour de force.
And she gets so much adoration. She fancy walks, bats her eyes, and waves her hand, and the entire place goes nuts. Every single person but me knew the lyrics. all in all, fantastic experience. If you're going, enjoy it. Morales says it's annoying everybody. Is it annoying everybody?
People are not happy with it, but I mean, it's fine. She's in town. Yeah, you went to it.
By the way, for people who are not talking about this,
yeah.
I was listening to Bill Simmons' podcast the other day, and he thinks it's the biggest concert thing in the last 40 years to hit America.
Last 40 years?
Yeah. I mean, it's like you can't go anywhere and not hear it. I mean, people are talking about it, and I mean, I live in Manhattan Beach, you live in Venice, everybody's talking about
it. I read that this tour is going to gross $1 billion.
Doesn't surprise me.
$1 billion for
fancy
walking.
She's a one-woman economy.
Yeah, she really is. She really is. So if you're on your way there, you're going to have a blast. It was just as good as Emily and Tyler and everybody said it was. Momo said it was too. Just an amazing night and really cool and glad I was there and part of it. And I did make it home by 1 a.m. And you know, John, day after 1 a.m., I don't necessarily do my best work, but it seems to be going okay.
Yeah,
so
you're doing fine.
Yeah. Andrew Friedman at the trade deadline made some acquisitions, and we were very, very upset when on that last day, Eduardo Rodriguez said no, vetoed the trade. They fell through with Dylan Cease and some other players. Lucas Giolito, at one point, they had conversations with. He, of course, went to the Angels. So listen to the five guys that Andrew Friedman acquired.
Okay.
Kike Hernandez. In 11 games, he's batting .324 with an .891 OPS.
Wow. And he wasn't doing that in Boston.
Ahmed Rosario, 9 games, 9 RBIs. Lance Lynn, 2 starts, 13 innings, 2-0. Joe Kelly, 3 games, no runs, 5 strikeouts. And Ryan Yarbrough, 4 1/3 innings, 1 earned run.
Yeah. I mean, he does year.
He's just smarter than everybody else.
Yep.
He is just the smartest guy in baseball, without question. And then Dodgers are now on the international market going to try to sign a pitcher from the Korean. I guess he's not with the Korean Baseball League. It's before he even starts with the Korean Baseball League. His name is Hyung-Suk Yang. My apologies. I have no idea how to say it. He was supposed to be a number one pick, signed with an MLB club, and he's skipping KBO altogether, skipping the Korean Baseball League, skipping the Japanese
League. Well, I think the success of Ohtani is going to open up the Asian markets like never before.
Right.
Everybody's going to be looking for the next Shohei Ohtani.
Yeah.
I don't know if there is one.
No, but, there's not. You can look. There ain't nobody like that.
Hey, I know Ohtani gets paid a lot of money.
Right.
And I know he's a free agent at the end of this year.
Yeah.
But if the Angels continue to circle the drain, and they've lost seven in a row since the trade deadline, they're almost, when he gets mathematically eliminated.
Right.
Should he keep playing?
Oh, that's interesting.
I mean, people are paying to see him. Like, people that are buying tickets want to come see him play. It's like if he was having a concert, he's not going to cancel the concert.
Say, people want to see the stars.
Right, but he's a free agent about to get paid. If he gets hurt, it's kind of like the argument where college players, before they're about to turn pro,
don't
play
to their
bowl
games. Yeah.
What do you think, Bergman? Should he keep playing?
Yeah, I think he's going to.
If they get mathematically eliminated?
I think you just keep playing. I think it would kind of put a bad stink on you of like, oh, yeah, you're out, so you're just going
to not for me. I don't think
team.
He has anything to prove.
Every single fan, like you were saying, is going to Angel Stadium to see Shohei Ohtani play, pitch. Maybe he doesn't pitch anymore. Maybe he just
That's
hits.
What I was thinking. Maybe he doesn't pitch anymore.
That's a good compromise.
Hits. Yeah.
Like, I'll still go out there. I'll DH. I'll do all that, but I don't want to pitch anymore.
Yeah, he's got
arm.
40 bombs right now. See how many he can get. He's going to be the MVP, and don't risk your arm.
No. So, yeah, if you get mathematically eliminated, stop pitching.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. Now, when do they get mathematically eliminated?
Tomorrow.
I think it's probably pretty...
It's pretty close.
Pretty close that they're going to be out of it. And they're going to be out of the Shohei Ohtani business. Unless I talked to somebody who knows people over there.
Knows people at the Angels?
Yes.
Okay.
And they think the Angels still believe they have a chance to keep Ohtani.
This reminds me of the time I told you that LeBron was going to Miami, and you said, of course he's not going to Miami. He's going to stay in Cleveland. Why would Cleveland, blah, blah, blah. And everybody in Cleveland thought he was staying?
Yeah.
I don't think there's a chance Shohei Ohtani stays.
You don't think so? Not a chance. Zero.
I'll give it 0.1%.
0.1%? I think it's higher than that.
But why would he stay? What reason is
right,
there
so
for him to stay?
Let me hit you with some facts. Yeah. The Angels have missed the playoffs for seven straight seasons. It's the longest streak in Major League Baseball. And Ohtani's been on the team for six of those seven seasons.
Right.
He's seen this movie. He knows how it ends. Why would he keep staying?
Okay, well, let's do this. What are the percentage chance that the Dodgers get Shohei Ohtani this year?
I would argue as good as anyone else, but having said that, it could go to any one of 30 teams, so I would put the Dodgers at the top of the list, but only at about 15%.
Only 15? I'm putting the Dodgers at 50%.
Okay.
50%? Wow.
50%.
I'm going 52.
You got 50 also?
Yeah.
25?
No, I think it's
4-1.
I think there are four teams that I would put at 15%.
So,
okay.
Well, why don't you just do 25% then?
No, but that because I think other teams will try and get in it. Like the four teams that I think he seriously considers are Dodgers, Giants, Mariners, and I'm throwing the Angels in there just because I think the Angels could come up with some circus offer.
So you think he stays on the West Coast no matter what?
I do.
But, okay, so...
So you think he would go in division to Seattle?
Sure. Yes.
Well, I don't think he cares about the division.
No, I don't think he does.
But
I
got a weird feeling about San Francisco.
I do, too.
Farhan Zaidi is crafty. There's that... He could hit bombs into that bay out there, McCovey Cove.
He can.
It's the Asian-American population in San Francisco. It's huge.
They've got money. They went big after Aaron Judge last year, so they've got money up there.
I got a bad feeling that the Giants could swoop
in
there.
See, I got a bad feeling about Seattle because at one point during the All-Star break, Shohei was asked about the fans in Seattle who were chanting, you know, we want Shohei or whatever it was. Come to Seattle.
So maybe it's 25 Dodgers, 25 Giants, 25 Mariners, 25 other?
Yeah, he says he's stayed in Seattle 2 years during the off season, so it suggests that he's got some sort of comfortability. Is that a word?
Comfortability. Yeah.
With the city of Seattle, but I've got it. Dodgers 50, San Francisco 20, Seattle 20, Angels 10. I think it'll be one of those four teams, and I'm giving the Angels a 10% chance.
Okay.
Because they think they can.
Wait, but why 10%? Like that seems very high for a team that has done nothing that.
Well, because
makes them want to stay.
Do you see a team that you would put on there instead? other than Dodgers, San Francisco, Seattle, and the Angels, who else would you stick with?
I mean, you have to put teams like Houston and the Yankees and Mets in there.
I don't think the Yankees and the Mets are in the Shohei Ohtani business.
I mean, I think they would love to have him.
Oh, of course they would.
But he has to go to the East Coast. I do think he stays on the West Coast, but you have to give them a shot over the Angels. I don't think there's any possibility the Angels keep him after all this.
I think there's a chance.
So you're telling me there's a chance?
Yes.
It just doesn't. It would be the weirdest move ever.
I can't. This Orioles announcer story is like the lead story on SportsCenter.
Well, I mean, it's ridiculous. If you missed this, the announcer for the Baltimore Orioles opened a broadcast by talking about the success of Tampa versus the Orioles, or the struggles that the Orioles have had with Tampa over the last few years. He was suspended for saying all this stuff that was 100% true.
And in context, not that offensive.
No, not that offensive.
I mean, not offensive at all.
Yeah, not offensive. And I think organizations can be very... Now, go a little bit inside here. So I am not limited on... I used to be limited on what I could say about USC.
Right.
I no longer work for USC, so now I can say whatever I want about the Trojans. I've never been limited on what I could say about the Lakers. Nobody ever said, hey, don't talk about this anymore. Never happened. Going back to the days of Slow Roy, if you remember.
Slow Roy. John Black loves Slow Roy.
Oh, he loves Slow Roy. And, you know, I think that the Dodgers never hear word one about criticism. Now, a lot
Slow
of this stuff
Roy.
Becomes, oh, wow, we have it.
Year of Slow Roy.
Becomes, that was a memorable year. It's a memorable year.
Slow Roy.
Yeah, Slow Roy. So, in the end, I think that you're limited a little bit in what you can say.
Yep.
But for the most part, we're free and clear. Now, if you're listening to, let's say, I'm just going to call out, let's just tell some truth here. AM 830, they're not allowed to say anything bad about the Angels because they own the radio station.
Right.
570
is limited, yeah.
Yeah, they're owned by the Dodgers. They're not allowed to say what's going on. So there's an advantage to not being a rights holder, but the people that the teams that we work with, Rams and the Lakers, never do we get edicts. Don't talk about this. Don't talk about that. You went too far on this. Never get that. So that's a credit to our
partners. I do sometimes, but that's because I work for them.
Yeah, no, you're an employee, so you're in a different category.
But what I said this earlier, what they'll say to me is, look, we know we're going to get criticized, particularly on sports radio. We just don't think it should come from you.
Right.
I can live with that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. All right, coming up next, is there anybody artistic that listens to us, do you think?
I don't know.
Because I've got a favor to ask. And we'll do that.
Let's find out.
We'll do that coming up next. Plus, Jalen Hurts of the Eagles is following two legends when it comes to diagnosing his game. I'll tell you who they are coming up next. Mason Ireland, 710 ESPN.
The fun way to.
the most downloaded sports radio show in Los Angeles. Let's continue. Mason in Ireland, right now on Swift 710.
So anyway, I'm sitting there listening to the Blueprint podcast with Pau Gasol.
Oh, that's cold, man.
And it is very, very good. It is very good.
What about the Blueprint podcast with D-Hawk and K-Lou and P-Bell?
You know, it is... They should have trademarked the Blueprint.
Right.
That's the now, are you going to change the name of the podcast, Cody? No, he's like the shrug hands.
Well, yeah.
Shrug
he
emoji.
He just gave you the shrug emoji.
Shrug emoji. I don't know.
You know there's like 35 other podcasts called the Blueprint.
Are there?
Yeah. There's
well,
a
somebody
there's
should
a
copyright it because then you get paid. Like, you know, every time somebody
copyright
uses
it,
the
Cody.
Phrase three-peat,
yeah.
Pat Riley gets paid?
Yeah.
Because he copyrighted it.
Yep.
There are some things you can't copyright, but I would think you could copyright a podcast named The Blueprint.
Oh, I'm sure you can.
Do you own the copyright on the Culture Pop
yes,
podcast?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of the first things I did. There's only I only
what,
see,
it cost, what, $200 to copyright it? Something like
maybe,
that?
Maybe three to $400.
Yeah.
Dollars. I only see one Blueprint podcast. I don't see multiples. Oh, nope, there's another one. There's another one. Oh, there's another one.
Yeah, there's a lot of them.
Yeah, there's one. Wow, there are so many. Why did you pick such a played-out name?
Come on, Clue.
Clue.
Come here, Clue.
Yeah, were you involved
Dr.
in that?
Dr. Eric Corum.
Yeah.
Has the Blueprint.
Yep, Dr. Eric Corum. I've got...
The Blueprint, which is about Chelsea FC and how it changed football.
Yeah.
There
all,
you go.
All that stuff. Yeah, so you guys got to start from scratch.
So, Mace, somebody says...
Start from scratch podcast.
Somebody is asking, how much was parking last night at SoFi?
Oh, that's a good question.
That's, he says, that you don't think about how much money they make on that. But you had a parking pass, right?
Yeah,
do
we
you
had
remember
a parking
what you paid
pass.
For it?
I don't. It came with the tickets because I didn't pay. Everybody's commenting on my seats. There's a picture on Instagram and on Twitter. The reason I got those seats is because I'm a season ticket holder and I was part
from
of
the
some
Rams.
Random
and they
drawing.
You get offered... chances to go to other events at SoFi
correct.
By nature of your season ticket.
You know
the
next
Rams.
One, right?
No.
Rihanna. I'm sorry, no. Beyonce. Beyonce is at SoFi in
that's the Renaissance
September,
tour.
The Renaissance tour.
Nice.
Okay. So that's the next big tour. And then Pink is coming. You know where I want to go? I want to go out to Yamava for the Killers. Do you like the Killers?
I love the Killers. They're great. They're supposed to be amazing in
they're
concert,
supposed
too.
To be great. Yeah, yeah, they're at Yamava.
When is that happening?
That's like mid-September. Yamava is getting
yeah, they're getting a lot of good bands.
They are getting a lot of talent.
And that's a beautiful hotel.
In October, they're having 311. Anybody in? Anybody
nope,
in with me?
Not for
311?
That one. Not
no.
For that
if it was
nobody?
Any other night.
Yeah, Brian, you in on 311?
No. I've seen them before. They, no. Okay.
Oh,
yeah. It was an
underwhelming they're great in concert.
I'll go see 411. I went 411, not 311.
No. 311 is great. They're really good in concert, too.
It's a, remember that? Remember you called information 411?
You
do
still
you guys
can.
Remember that?
Yeah, you still can.
Can you?
Yeah.
It used to
what's
be,
the 411?
I need a phone number, 411, and you would get somebody's phone number.
Yeah, what's the 411?
What's the 411?
Nobody jingles in the Watch What Happened Live, his open.
Is it?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Andy Cohen's got the 411.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go. So this is my idea. This is a grand scheme. So I want somebody who has real artistic ability to create caricatures of us.
For the purpose of what?
For a brand new t-shirt that we're going to launch.
Oh, okay.
So, Bergman, we're launching a brand new t-shirt. It's going to have caricatures of us.
Okay.
Now, who can you... Do you know anybody that does art?
I don't know
do we have
any
anybody on staff who does art?
I don't know the answer to that.
Do we have to go down like to the Venice Boardwalk and just have somebody do it on the Venice Boardwalk?
If you want somebody that knows a guy, Scott Kaplan.
No, I know a guy.
Never come through.
I know a guy.
Do you know a guy?
All right, so let me see.
You're not just Kaplaning this, are you?
No.
You actually do know a guy.
Yeah, he sends me when he does artwork. He sends me, here, scroll through. I'll show you the one I bought from him.
Kaplan for sure has a characterist guy.
Okay, here, scroll through these, Mace. Just
okay.
Scroll up and down. This is an artist I know
okay.
That does it as a hobby, but I bet you he would do it
oh,
for
wow.
Us.
Oh, wow. There's a little John Madden.
Yeah, I bet you he would do it for us, if you want me to ask him.
Yeah, ask him.
He did a...
these are great.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, he's good. Yeah.
All right, so I can get him on the case, but we'll see.
Bergman, do we have budget for a whole bunch of T-shirts?
No.
None?
No, this is coming out of your pocket.
What about...
We can talk to the Fun and Games department.
Yeah, let's talk to them.
We can talk to them.
Because we're almost out. I think we're out of Mason and Ireland.
We are absolutely right,
so
out
So, Mace, this is the one I bought from him that I'm going to hang at my house in Idaho.
Oh, really?
I bought it for $150. What do you think? It's worthy Kareem, Magic, and Cooper.
That is fantastic.
Yeah, so yeah. He would do something like that. He could do the four of us.
Really cool.
Okay.
All right, and we'll work on the budget. We're working on the budget.
Always working on the budget.
All right, cool. Hey, do you have a fantasy football league that you want to be part of our Ultimate Fantasy Football Draft Friday, August 18th at Hollywood Park Casino with the 710 crew? Register now at ESPNLA.com. Be with us for a fantasy party. Hollywood Park Casino. Eat, drink, and play. And draft. So... this is interesting. You know, I think it's fair to say that Kobe Bryant's legacy is all of the athletes who are emulating his approach to their sport.
Mamba mentality.
The Mamba mentality. So I came across this from Jalen Hurts. He says, every time you go into the offseason, for me at least, I look at guys like MJ and Kobe and how they diagnose their game. Obviously, two different sports, but trying to get better at my strengths and then turning my weaknesses into my strengths. I've always been a unique player, but embracing the rarity of being a true triple threat guy, throwing, running, and mind. For a long time, people said guys like me couldn't think or couldn't process, trying to put that to sleep. You know, I still think that running quarterbacks, there is a risk with running. And Jalen Hurts does it. And
Lamar Jackson
does it. These guys that scramble and run. And there's a difference, I guess, between scrambling and running. Like Patrick Mahomes is technically scrambling. He's very slippery. It's hard to bring him down.
Right, but
he's got great escapability.
You hit the right note when you say running quarterbacks. I'm gonna take a look at the NFL standing so I can make sure I'm at least maybe out. But I think we're down to only two that you would describe. Like, is Russell Wilson a running quarterback?
Not anymore.
Okay, so how about Kyler Murray?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know when he's coming back, but he's a scrambler.
Okay, but I guess Jordan Love's going to try it.
Yeah, Jordan Love is going to try Justin Fields.
Yeah, Justin Fields is,
Justin
for sure.
Fields is definitely
So the
that.
Ones you would say, no questions asked. Guys who could rush for 1,000 yards.
Yeah.
Lamar Jackson, Justin Fields. I'm trying to think of anybody else. Jalen Hurts could rush for 1,000 yards, you think?
Yeah, I think he could.
So Lamar Jackson, Justin Fields, Jalen Hurts. Oh, you know who runs? Danny Dimes, Daniel Jones.
Oh, yes, he does.
Okay, so that's four. But Josh Allen's not going to rush for 1,000 yards. He can run. He's a good runner. But he's
Justin Fields ran for 1,100 yards last year?
Yeah, he's really good. Why so many people are betting on him to win the MVP, but I don't think the Bears are going to be any good.
I don't think they're going to be good enough to do anything, but that's a good fantasy quarterback. Have you started thinking, have you done any mock drafts yet? You're a big mock draft
Yeah,
guy.
Well, but I'm not doing as much work as I usually do because I'm going to be on that plane coming home.
And you're going to kind of auto pick
I may have to auto draft, yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't want to do a ton of work and then get burned by the airline internet and then have to auto draft anyway, but I'll be ready.
Yeah. No, it'll be fine. I'm excited because I'm on a roll now.
You finished in the money last year for the first time in years.
I'm doing it. I'm doing it this time. All right. One national NBA writer says that what LeBron is doing is still underappreciated. Hey, you want to win a chance to play golf with John Ireland and Corporate Greg? Terranea Resort and ESPN LA are giving away a round of golf at the Links at Terranea. Lunch with Ireland and Greg. All you got to do is post a video of your golf swing on Instagram or Twitter. Tag at ESPN Los Angeles. We will review the best swings, and you could be playing golf with Ireland and Corporate Greg at the Links at Terranea.
Bergman, how many strokes are you giving me in this match?
How many strokes am I giving you?
Yeah. Because last time I gave you a bunch of strokes, you won all the money. Well, so right. Now you got to give me strokes.
I
know.
I get my own strokes here. That's what I won.
Isn't he about 20 strokes?
Yeah. Yeah, but he won all the money. That's what we did last year. We gave him too many strokes, and he won all the money.
It wasn't even that. It was because I hit like a tree, and then I made it.
Yeah, you got a lot of dots.
How many strokes did he give you last time?
One per hole, I think.
Yeah, I think we gave him one a hole. Yeah. I gave him 18.
Oh, you won. And he still won money.
Yeah, he won all the money.
That's right.
He did really well.
I won the money.
I gave mine. Three shots a hole.
Three shots a hole. Yeah, three
I
shots
I gave
a
you
hole.
27 strokes. Yeah.
And, you know, since our big golf showdown.
Have you picked up a club since then?
Have not picked up a club. I have not picked up a pickleball racket. I have not. All these things that I say, okay, I'm really going to stick. I don't have much stick-to-itness.
By the way, Bergman, we've added, since I played with you the last time, we've added way more dots.
More?
So the next time you play, we're
What's
up.
That mean?
Well, here, I'll when we come back, I'll tell you, I think there's 21 ways you can make money when you play golf with me.
Okay.
And so I'll share some of them with you when we
All
come
right.
back.
All right, that's coming up. Mason, Ireland, 710 ESPN.
Okay, did you know? It can now take up to 11 weeks on average to hire for an open job. That's 2.5 months. You don't have that kind of time. So if you're listening today, stop waiting. Start using ZipRecruiter. They can help you find qualified candidates for all your roles fast. And right now you can try it for free at ZipRecruiter.com/LA. My buddy Ian Siegel, who invented ZipRecruiter, says, we don't leave anything to chance. And here's what he means. They use powerful matching technology to quickly find and send you the most qualified people for your roles. They'll send you all these people. You can do what you want with the information. You can hire. You can contact them in one click, or you can ignore it. Doesn't matter. But this is free, and they'll send you these great suggestions. So what are you waiting for? Try ZipRecruiter today. Go to that website for free. ZipRecruiter.com/LA. Again, that's ZipRecruiter.com/LA. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire.
The Black and Gold. The Black and Gold dominated in their.
Hey, ESPN LA listeners, it's John Ireland. You want to play golf with me and corporate Greg Bergman? You can, thanks to Terranea. If you listen to the show, you know Terranea is my favorite place in the world. It's like going to Hawaii without getting on a plane. Well, you can play golf with Bergman and I at the links of Terranea, and then we'll buy you lunch. Here's how you win. Send a video of your golf swing to @ESPN Los Angeles on Instagram or on Twitter. We'll take a look at your golf swing. If you impress us, you'll be playing golf at Terranea with me and Bergman, and then we'll buy you lunch. And you can all you can eat, all you can drink. We don't care. We're not paying.
The Black and Gold dominated in their League's Cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals. LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL Tuesday night. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
Hit a bird, make par.
You actually hit a...
If you happen to hit a bird.
A live bird. You hit a live bird.
I've never seen it happen.
Yeah. So this dot is unlikely to score.
Not yet.
Okay.
Haven't seen it happen. Eagle?
You don't hit an eagle, do
no,
you?
No, no. An eagle is two below par. You get two dots. Figaro, you know what that is?
No.
First dot of the day.
You get the first dot, person to score.
Fred Astaire, you know what that is?
Ball dances?
You're teeing off and your foot slips.
Really?
And you make par. That's a Fred Astaire.
That's a Fred Astaire?
Yeah. All right. Greeny, if you hit it on the green and you're the closest one to the hole and you make par, you get a dot.
Right.
Hokey pokey. You know what that is?
No.
Your ball's in the sand, but you have 1 foot in and 1 foot out.
Okay. The hokey pokey.
Yeah. So that's a dot. And Ireland, this is named after me, is if you make a long putt that is twice the length of the pole.
Okay.
All right. So then you get a dot. Lockout is if you win all the greenies. Mermaid. Yep. You know what a mermaid is?
No.
Hit the ball in the water and make par. Very hard to do. I've only seen it once.
Yeah.
There are a pulley is length of the putt. Rattler. You hit the stick and make par.
Okay.
That's a dot. Sandy.
If you hit it out of the sand.
You get it out of there. Some of these you guys won't understand. Turtle is if you win three in a row. If you and I are playing against those two, we win three holes in a row, we get a dot. A Viagra. You know what that is?
I have no idea. I believe it's not something
so
I know.
So if you hit it, like
about.
Bergman, you had a couple of these. You hit a tree and you made par.
Every time.
Okay.
Yeah.
And if you get five of those, we call that a Woody. If you hit a tree and make par,
okay,
you get five Woodies. That's a Viagra.
That's
and you
a Viagra.
Get an extra dot.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
Yeah. So those are just some.
So how
of the,
much did Bergman win?
I don't remember, Greg. How much did you win?
35, 40 bucks.
Yeah, he did well.
Yeah.
He kept getting these dots.
So how much do you win when you play?
Normally, no more between $10 and $20 you either win or lose. That's it.
Yeah. So
this means I was really bad, but somehow saved myself and got par.
Well, I mean, you're getting points for
you're getting
a tree.
Strokes. Yeah, and he took advantage of his strokes. And then you got the dot doubler because if you get the five main ones, you double all your dots. So he had a birdie, greenie, sandy, barky, poley. And by hitting those five, he doubled his dots.
Wow.
So I made money.
So that's how he made money.
Yeah, nice.
Hey, you mentioned that, I think this is the story you were talking about. You mentioned that Sam Amick wrote in The Athletic about LeBron the other day. And I never had thought about this because I think we get, I've said this before, one of the hardest things is it's going on right now with Messi.
Mm-hmm.
It's going on right now with Taylor Swift.
Yep.
Is recognizing greatness while it's happening in real time. So Sam Amick asked an interesting question. He said, are we, even though he gets tons of money and tons of acclaim, are we actually underrating LeBron at this stage of his career? Here's what he wrote. What LeBron did last season and what he looks fully capable of doing for the foreseeable future has never been done by a player at this stage of life. And it's not even close. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar didn't do it. Michael Jordan didn't do it. He's actually averaging 28, 10, and 10.
Yeah.
Just under a triple-double. I mean, I think we take guys like that for granted.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I think...
The guy's 38 years old.
I mean, honestly, he is so much better...
At
this age than anybody has ever been.
Yeah, I just watched the Wilt documentary. Like, the Jordan, I covered the end of Jordan's career. When Jordan was with the Wizards,
yeah,
he didn't do this.
Wilt tailed off, but not tailed off a lot.
Right.
What's weird is Wilt retired... while still being productive.
Right.
But LeBron is going to...
Jordan, I think, averaged 20 a game his last year.
Oh, did he?
He played for the Wizards, but he was on a bad team.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, honestly, if you can see LeBron James in person, someday you will tell your kids and your grandkids, probably your grandkids, that you saw LeBron. I mean, I love the fact that I got to be there the night he broke the record, which was super cool.
Right.
A great moment. I loved the night I was there after Kobe passed away and LeBron did the speech, the iconic speech for the crowd there. I mean, I just think he is a uniquely talented athlete who we will not see the likes of anytime soon.
I always, when I was dating Lisa, and we'd been dating for a few years, and I thought we'd probably get married, there were a couple of people I said, look, who knows what life has in store for both of us, but I want you to be able to say that you saw these two people in person. So I made her go see Michael Jordan in person, and I made her go see Wayne Gretzky in person. She wasn't all that interested, but just so she could say that she did it.
Well, this is like that story I've told. This is not the same story. Thank you. I was going to play the same thing myself. Is that when I was a little kid, I was probably 3 years old, Mrs. Demmerly sat me down in front of the TV and said, look at this. And it was the moon landing. It was Neil Armstrong. And I remember it only because she sat me down and said, remember this. So now I remember the first steps on the moon.
There you go.
So it's a matter of acknowledging what you're seeing is greatness. All right. So we're going to do a little game of games. I think Jacob and Ronnie's here for it. Before I do that, right now, caller number
seven.
Seven. Okay, I'll do you a favor. Do you a solid. Caller number seven right now. Four pack of tickets. Go see LAFC tonight versus Real Salt Lake. We've got that right now for you. Make sure you can make it to the game. 877-710-ESPN, 877-710-ESPN. Again, if you can make tonight's LAFC game, caller number seven right now, you got tickets. We're going to do Game of Games with Jacob and Ronnie coming up next. Mason, Ireland, 710-ESPN.
ESPN.
And it is time for Game of Games on the number one sports radio show in L.A., Mason and Ireland.
Game of Games.
Game of Games presented by CallJacob.com.
Call Jacob.
Everyone loves a fighter, but in this town, winning matters, especially after an accident. So remember, anyone can fight, but CallJacob.com is here for you when you need a big win. After an accident, go to CallJacob.com or call 844-24-JACOB. That's 844-24-JACOB. We got the jingle.
Call Jacob.
Thank you. Game of Games time. Take it away, Mace.
All right, here we go. It is Game of Games time. And we are joined today by the great Jacob Imrani. Jacob, how you doing? How you feeling?
I'm doing fantastic.
How
you doing?
Hot out there, right?
Oh, my God. It's very muggy. I feel like I'm in Miami.
Yeah,
it's been very muggy. And by the way, this week's been cooler than what they're expecting for next week.
Seriously?
So enjoy this while it lasts. Oh, wow. How muggy was it last night at the concert?
It was totally chill. Totally
good?
Cool. Yeah,
okay.
It was nice. All right, so it is Brian's game today. And Brian, what do we got cooking?
All right, so today is August 8th or 8-8. So we have some multiple-choice trivia on professional players that wore the number 88.
88?
Okay. All right.
I don't know a single one
game.
Off the top of my head,
all right,
but
here
it's
we
a
go.
Good game.
All right, for the first one, number one, currently donning 88 on the White Sox, one-time All-Star Luis Robert Jr. has how many career home runs? 42, 66, or 71?
Bergman.
42, 66, 71. I feel like he got injured. 42.
Wait, I heard Jorge wanted to play. Are you back there, Jorge?
Yeah, yeah.
Right, what's
66.
What's up? Mace.
42.
I'm going 66. Jacob.
I'm going 42.
Jorge and John are right. 66.
Okay. 66.
Yeah. Swag,
swag system's
back.
Who is this interloper who has joined Game of
Games?
I'm
over here.
Yeah.
Behind the mic.
And your name is?
Jorge.
J.
Nice. Vote for Jorge. Not with an H.
Number two.
That was for Brian, actually.
Three-time Stanley Cup champion Patrick Kane has how many career goals? 451, 463, or 482?
Jorge.
What was the middle one?
463.
482.
I actually... Oh, no, this one is Mace.
Was 493 one of the choices?
451, 463,
463.
482.
That's what I want, 463.
I'll go 482, Jacob.
I'll go 482.
Greg.
I'll be different and go 451.
Greg is right, 451.
All right, Bergman's on the board. Man. Three-way tie for the lead.
Number three, 2020 NBA champ Markieff Morris rocked 88 when he was on the Lakers.
Yes, he did.
How many total points did Morris score in the 2020 finals?
Okay.
A, 51, B, 49, or C, 45?
Mace.
45.
I actually agree with Mason. I think it's 45. But Jacob?
I will go with 45 as well.
Greg?
Just because John called all those games, I'm going to say 45.
Jorge?
49. 49ers.
It is 45.
Yeah!
All right, so everybody except the Niner fan?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right.
Good.
Jacob's on the board. Yeah. Greg, you and I are tied for the lead.
Yes, sir.
Rams wide receiver Torrey Holt wore number 88 for the first 3 years of his career. He played 11 seasons and finished with 920 career receptions. How many receptions did Holt have while he wore number 88? A, 194, B, 207, or C, 215?
Jesus.
Wow, this is a hard one.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 215, Jacob.
I'm going to go with B, whatever that was.
What was B, Brian?
207.
All right, so I'm going 215. Jacob's going 207. Greg?
What was the A?
194.
I don't like that one. B.
All right, you're going 207. Jorge.
207.
Mace.
215.
It is 215.
Boom.
Yeah.
Mason and Ireland, only right ones. Jacob's up next. Go ahead.
All right, Hall of Fame wide receiver Marvin Harrison wore 88 his whole career with the Colts. How many times did Harrison make the Pro Bowl? A, 6, B, 8, or C, 10?
6, 8, or 10 for Marvin Harrison, Jacob.
I'll go with 8.
Greg.
That feels right. I'm with Jacob, 8.
Jorge.
Yeah, Ocho.
Mace.
I'm going to try to snake a point and go 6.
I think it's 8.
It is 8.
Yeah. Okay, so everybody but Mason.
Damn.
Okay, so right now it's Ireland 4, Bergman 3, everybody else 2.
Okay.
I got three more.
Got it.
Hall of Fame tight end Tony Gonzalez had how many career touchdowns? A, 111. B, 116, or C, 124?
Yeah, whoever's leading has to go first.
Oh, that's me. He had a lot. The question is...
A lot is not
the question
an answer.
It's not like DeAndre. Yeah.
Is 124. A lot
of nothing.
I'm going to say 116. Greg.
It was 111, 116, 124?
Correct.
124.
Jorge.
116.
Mace.
124.
Jacob.
Personal friend of mine, Tony Gonzalez. I'm going to go with 124 as well.
Oh, it was A, 111.
No!
Oh, my God.
Nobody got it. All right.
So I think some of us are out.
No, two left, and everybody is only two back.
Okay.
Right? But you do have to go different than where I go.
Right.
Okay.
Well, I'm one back of you, right?
Yes, you are only one back. All right, go ahead, Brian.
All right, Hall of Fame wide receiver Michael Irvin played 12 years for the Cowboys. How many games did Michael Irvin play in? A, 172, B, 159, or C, 145?
All right, give me the numbers again.
172, 159, 145. Career games that Michael Irvin played in.
I'm going to go 172. Greg.
Do I wait for the next question? I'm going to try and get my point. Now I'm going to do the B one. What was it, 145?
159.
159, that's what I want.
Okay, Jorge.
145.
Mace.
C is 145, right? That's the one I'm going.
Jacob.
I'm going with 159 as well.
It was 159.
Hey! Right, so who got it?
Jacob and I, right?
Yep.
So we have a tie ball C game?
No, I got... So didn't I get that one? That was Jacob and I got
it. And I got it.
Okay, yeah. So Greg, you have tied me.
I've tied you, and Jacob's one back.
Jacob's one back. Mason and Jorge are out. Okay, damn. So this is the last question.
No swag system
nice
for
work,
you.
Corey. All right,
Greg, you got to go first, and then I'll go second. Jacob goes third. Here we go. Brian, last one, right? Do you have a tiebreaker?
I do, yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Former tight end and current broadcaster Greg Olson played how many years in the NFL?
Oh, wow.
A, 13, B, 14, or C, 12?
Greg.
So I had 12 in my head as soon as you said Greg Olson, so I'm going to stick with 12.
Oh, interesting.
Man, I think you're right. This is going to open the door for Jacob. I'm also going 12.
Okay,
so
Jacob.
I will go 13.
It was B, 14.
Oh,
Jacob, you were right there.
So Jacob's out. Bergman and I go to the tiebreaker as usual.
That's how that works.
All right, here we go.
Sorry,
Jacob. You got something to write down, Greg?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Is that? I need a pen.
I was right there.
Yeah, you were right there.
Right there.
I thought this was your day, too.
All right, go ahead, Brian.
I really did.
All right, so I've named three wide receivers already, Torrey Holt, Marvin Harrison, and Michael Irvin. How many combined career receptions do they have? Closest to the number without going over.
Oh, my goodness.
Okay. So.
It's Harrison.
Holt. It's and Irvin. And
closest Irvin. Without going over, just closest?
Yes, closest without going over.
Okay.
Oh, without going over. Okay.
So, jeez, okay. So, the each of them around. Okay. Greg, did you write something down?
I did.
Okay.
All right. I wrote down 2,222.
Okay. See, I thought you were going to go over, so I went low, and okay. I just said 502.
All right.
Ugh. This one's going to be John because it's 2,772.
No! Oh, wow. I thought you were going to go
John.
Over.
Break that.
I thought
John.
John.
Bergman with the win.
No.
Oh, John. You won?
No,
yeah.
John won.
Oh,
that's yeah, right. I thought he was going to go
John's
over.
Like, no.
Yeah.
No.
As you know, I take this very seriously.
As
a little
do.
Part of you dies, right, Greg?
It's absolutely true.
Yeah, I'm fully dead. So, Jacob, we've got an issue going on right now.
All right, hey, Cody, get in here.
Yeah, come on, Clue.
All right, so, Jacob, this is a dilemma that we need some legal expertise on. All right, so Cody, Parker, and DeAndre, who are three young guys that work here, have a podcast, all right?
Uh-huh.
This is Cody, if you've
of course,
never met
I know
him.
Cody,
okay.
Of course.
Cody, sit. That mic doesn't work, right? Yeah, Cody, just hang there for a second.
Yeah, hang there
for a second. And hit...
That button. Okay. Okay.
So, they have a podcast, Jacob, called The Blueprint. Okay.
It's a great name, isn't it? That's
great.
A great name
now,
for a podcast.
Cody,
I love that name.
You guys started it when? Like 3-4 months ago?
Yeah, I would say 3-4 months.
And they've got five episodes.
Five episodes
in
the can. We've been coaching them up.
Let me just be clear. You've been doing it for 5 months and you've got
that 3-4 or I don't know, 3-4 months.
Five
is,
episodes in 3-4 months.
I don't know
months.
If that's the exact
just to give
I'm
you
very
a thing.
Slow
Mason's
numbers.
Done like 300 podcasts and has like five in the can.
I do two a week and I have a bunch ready to go.
All right, so Jacob, here's the dilemma. Pau Gasol came out yesterday and announced a new podcast. We love Pau.
Oh, he's great.
Called The Blueprint, which is the one, which is what Cody and DeAndre and Parker called their podcast. So my question is, they did not, Cody, Parker, and DeAndre did not copyright it, the name of their thing. Cody thinks, he just looked it up, and you think Pau did not copyright it either, right?
Yes, I don't think so.
Okay, the fact, Jacob, that Cody, Parker, and DeAndre had it first, does that give them any legal standing, or do they both get to call it The Blueprint?
So, full disclaimer.
Not a copyright.
Not true.
I don't. But from what I do know is the fact that whoever can show usage, if you go ahead and if you go ahead and copyright it, and then he copyrights it, and then you guys get into a battle, and you can show usage, and obviously you have a an audience, and you can prove you've done it. May have an argument.
Yeah. But the problem, Cody, is
Pau Gasol.
Yeah. Pau Gasol is gonna have like 1,000 downloads and you guys have like 40.
But here's the thing, you'll be able to file a legal injunction against Pau Gasol from using that name.
You can't file a legal injunction against the nicest guy ever.
We're gonna do it.
But imagine
Pau.
We're gonna do it.
Imagine how exciting it is if Pau comes in here and has a powwow with you about the blueprint.
Jacob, the suggestion I made to Cody, and Cody, what do you think of this, is we explained this to Pau, what happened. Pau agrees to come on their podcast, and they both use the name.
That is a guest. Home run right there. Not a weekly. Guest. That'd be great. He's not going to call you weekly.
No, weekly.
That's Debbie Downer over here.
Yeah, man, you really think Pau
Gasol
is going to shoot high?
You never know.
He has to shoot high.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
He's gonna slum once a week for Pau's the next
retired.
Time.
He's got nothing to do.
Oh, God.
Pau is internationally known. You guys are like...
He'll be on The Blueprint twice a week on his show and our show.
Sure.
Yeah, there you go. I don't think that's happening.
All right. Yeah. It's fun.
Well, Cody, I wish I had more legal advice for you, but if this comes down to usage, I think you're screwed.
We'll have an update.
Definitely
we're going to do it.
To that.
All right. Good luck.
Game of Games is brought to you by calljacob.com. Remember, Jacob and Ronnie, if you're involved in any kind of accident, 844-24-JACOB. That's 844-24-JACOB. Or remember, calljacob.com. Jacob, great seeing you, man.
Awesome as always.
Thanks for coming in. Coming up next for you is some super crosstalk.
ESPN AM 710 Los Angeles.
KRDC AM 1110 Pasadena, Los Angeles.
K256CX 99.1 FM Pasadena, Los Angeles.
It's the greatest segment in LA sports radio history.
Oh my God.
When the shows come together for magic on the radio.
If Bologna grows stronger. Super Crosstalk.
Are we ready for Sedano and Kaff to join Mason and Ireland?
Super Crosstalk begins!
Super Crosstalk, presented by Coors Light. Coors Light, made to chill.
It's time for Super Crosstalk.
Hey, look who's here!
Scott Kaplan in the house!
Beto and Cappy are here. And, I believe that's like what you hear before you go into battle.
No, that's what you hear at soccer games when it gets boring.
Is that a vuvuzela?
Sure.
Is that what it's called, a vuvuzela?
I think it's just a vuvuzela, ain't it? Whatever.
Vuvuzela. Yeah, I think that's what it is.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
Yeah.
What up, Mace? You look good, man.
Thank you, man.
Every time I see you, I always tell you look good, and you really do. Like, you lose weight every time I see you.
Thank you.
In a good way. Yeah. Like, toned up.
Yeah,
okay,
exactly.
So, Beto.
Irish, you're falling apart.
Thank you for that.
Actually, I'm surprised at your position on this, but you are, is it fair to say you're anti-Taylor Swift?
I'm anti-everybody talking about Taylor Swift.
Because you know,
I'm not mad at her, the artist, for making all the money. I'm anti-everybody and this station going above and beyond, and I'm done talking about it.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute.
I walked out yesterday.
I know.
Yeah.
But here's
like, it's not a bit. I'm just sick and tired of it.
But
it,
do you not...
I get in the car. You guys talk about the first segment. I go to the post office. I come back 20 minutes later. You're talking about it again.
Now, do you think we've really dwelled on? I don't think we've dwelled on it the way.
I kid you not. Funch was in the back. I was like, Funch, turn down the station. I don't want to hear.
Oh, really? Wow.
Because I just didn't want to hear.
You hate Taylor.
Why do you think you react that way?
Because it's been the last month about it, and I'm just sick and tired of it. It just irks me. It bugs me.
Are you ready for Beyonce? Because it's just.
I'd rather have Beyonce than all this Taylor Swift talk.
Yeah.
Then
because I need to
be quiet
because
I like working here, so I need to be quiet.
No, but I actually think that it is. Maybe I'd have to think harder. I mean, I was a little kid when the Beatles came through here, but I think it is the biggest concert event of my lifetime.
Well, cool. Don't talk about it here. Yeah. Simple as that. Like, Cappy, this ain't Kissette Fam.
Cappy, do you understand the
Cappy?
The
if position? You had to pick a side here, I think you acknowledge it's the biggest concert event of a lifetime. And Beto says, don't talk about it on a sports stage.
Yeah, it's even a sports stage. Just here,
just here.
Yeah,
you mean like where you are?
Whenever I'm around.
Yeah, whenever you're around. Yeah.
No, because my daughter's going tonight.
Good.
Oh, is she?
Yeah.
It's a great
show. You got
show.
Her She's in, or did she get herself?
See, guys. Good show.
Really resourceful.
No. She'll love it.
Yeah,
she'll love it.
Like Ireland at 412. I'm gone, guys.
Yeah.
It's like Mason at 420. I'm gone, guys.
So you had a good time?
Ah, great time.
Really? Do you know all the songs?
No, don't know any of them.
Come
I know
on.
Blank Space and I know Shake It Off. And beyond that, the girls I went with knew every single word to every single
Did
song.
Did you exchange like friendship bracelets with little girls?
They made friendship bracelets for me. I had no idea what to do with it, but I did wear these things.
See, the weird...
Beto, what do you think has been the biggest concert event of your lifetime?
Okay, I thought you were asking about my friendship bracelet.
You got any? No. Give me some.
Biggest concert event of your lifetime, Beto.
I don't know. I'm not a big music guy. So
you're not a big concert guy?
Oh, I can't afford it. Concert too.
What's the best concert you've ever been to?
Vicente Fernandez in Las Vegas on a Friday night. Then I saw him Saturday at Staples
What
Center.
Made him great?
Well, he's like Sinatra.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
He's like an icon, especially for Latinos, when he sings and you're singing along. And
Do they play his songs at Dodger Stadium?
Yeah, you've heard it over and over.
Yeah, El Rey, over and over, yeah.
El Rey that comes in. It just, for me, that's just a big... deal, but that was an icon because I was there with my brothers and my dad, so that
right,
was cool. But
right,
as
cool.
far as like the biggest venue, I don't know. Like, I'm not a concert guy.
You're not that big of a concert goer.
I do think where I kind of get what Beto's saying is that like it's hard for me, being serious, to like understand what the phenomenon is.
Right.
Like, she's a girl who sings songs and she puts on costumes and dances and sings.
Yep.
Like Madonna did, like Beyonce does,
yeah.
like all these other great artists do. What is it that creates this phenomenon where there's 75,000 people inside the stadium and by reports there are like thousands of people outside?
Yeah,
what is it?
I think it's this. Springsteen made a name for himself by always emptying the tank.
Yeah.
In other words,
I've heard that. Like,
you would buy
Pete Carroll would always talk about that when
you
come to
LA.
Yeah,
you would buy a concert ticket to go see Bruce Springsteen.
He'd do 4 hours.
By the way, he opened what was then Staples Center.
Yeah, he was the first event ever.
And
I'll go see Bruce just because I know you have to.
7:30.
Never seen him.
Cappy, 7:30, right. He would hit the stage, and he'd walk off at midnight.
Yeah.
And
gave you everything.
I think she's the modern-day Springsteen.
Is that the deal? Is that what it is, that she sings for so long?
Yeah, but we got three guys in here who don't listen to her.
She got.
You're talking about it.
She got, I forget how many songs she sang.
44.
Mace, why did you go? If you don't know any of the songs.
I do
cultural event.
Her, but here's the
that's
thing.
That's such an amazing thing.
Yeah.
So I want to
What did
be,
you say? Cultural what?
Event.
Yeah, that's
yeah,
right. That's why it's such a big deal.
I always use the term zeitgeist. You want to be where the zeitgeist is. Like, there was a point where people were playing Wordle, so we played Wordle. Whatever the big thing is, I like to
yeah,
be
you're
part
a big FOMO.
Big thing. No, because I never miss out.
See, I have the opposite of FOMO. My mom gave me a really good tip when I was young. This came up on the show recently. I said to her once, she said, how you doing? And I said, I'm not feeling great, but I got to go to this party tonight. And she said, is it going to be a good party? I go, it might be the party of the year. And her response was shaped the rest of my life. She said, well, if it's going to be the party of the year, no one's going to notice if you're not there. And I said,
I like
you know what?
Mom. Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
And so now I have like I haven't seen Ohtani play in person. I'd love to, because
mm-hmm.
I think it's a cultural event, and I'd love to say, and I will.
Yeah, he's going to be at Dodger Stadium next year.
Visiting with the Yankees? Or
Beto,
no.
No.
See, Beto, I love the assumption.
Right? Can you imagine,
I'm going with it.
Can you imagine if the Dodgers, and I think it's I'm with you, I think it's a long way off from assuming it, but if they put a team together next year that has, in the same lineup, Mookie Betts, Freddie Freeman, and Shohei Ohtani.
Yeah, fantastic.
I think it'll be the most, and think about this. Of all the great Dodgers we've ever seen, the old Dodger infield, the great teams that you know have been here that Andrew Friedman's put together over the last 10 years, that would be the better. Wouldn't it be the most loaded Dodger team of all time?
It's huge. And the fact that they had 48,000 the other night against the Reds on a Tuesday night or Wednesday night, whatever
right.
it is. Ohtani every single night. Ohtani's Angel Stadium, There's like 28,000 when he's playing. When he's not, it's like, oh, what do we got here?
Right.
It's just that's that phenomenon. You got to go see him just when he pitches.
And by the way, if it happens, and I think it's likely to happen that he winds up with the Dodgers.
Why do you think that?
Because Andrew Friedman actually tried to stay under the luxury tax. I think that's why he didn't bring anybody big at the trade deadline.
But there wasn't many people available at the trade deadline.
That's how you talk yourself into believing.
Okay, but Beto, why do you think they made no offer at all to trade Turner? Did they know something? He's gone.
Oh,
in
look
the,
at Beto's face.
He's gone in the tank this year.
He didn't want to be here.
Okay.
Trey did not want to be in the beach cities. He did not want to be on the West Coast.
But he's in the city where the fans are the most harsh.
Yeah, he's close enough to North Carolina.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of money there.
Okay. Yeah.
And Bryce Harper's here. It's a good team.
And the interesting.
And thing, I don't think they made an offer to Aaron Judge, did they?
No.
So, that was to Mace's point, what are they saving that money for? I think it's Ohtani. You may tell him no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just don't know if Ohtani would want to go there.
He may go to, I think, Seattle.
Seattle is the one.
San Francisco, I'm really worried
about. Sleeper, yeah.
Those cities where you can get away and do whatever you want and nobody bugs you, that's appealing.
Yeah, Ohtani at the trade deadline, or at the All-Star game, said he spent several off seasons in Seattle.
Nah. Well, and Ichiro had a great run up there. And you know, so.
But Ichiro ended up in New York also.
What's interesting, too, is Mookie, Freddie, and Ohtani, if he does come to the Dodgers, will be here for the next decade. They're signed.
Huge.
If you guys had to keep...
I'm just fascinated by how we went from getting this kid who was so angry about Taylor Swift.
Now he's happy. I'm angry about the people talking about
him. Now he's happy. Look at how happy he is.
We're actually talking about similar things.
Yeah,
here.
We are.
We're talking about a cultural experience.
Yep.
We're talking about stop what you're doing performers.
Still do that.
Right.
And whenever you're watching a game, you get the alert Ohtani's coming up.
Right. Ohtani's one of those guys. And even
he's
though,
the only one right now.
And
really.
Even though I don't really get it because I don't know all the songs,
right?
I have not understood this whole Taylor Swift thing all summer long. But your question about FOMO, I love what your mom told you, but I'm having FOMO that my daughter's going tonight and tomorrow night.
What's your wallet saying about that FOMO?
My wallet is saying, don't be such a jerk because you're not going to pay for those tickets. We know this, all right?
Yeah.
So forget about it.
I actually got a call earlier today saying if I wanted to go for free.
Get
out of
here. Come on. Let me see it.
You turn it down?
Hook
it
up. Absolutely. I'm going to the LAFC game, too.
Hook it up, though.
I think I would turn it down, too.
Hook Capia.
Yeah, hook it up. So I can go with my daughter. I can paint like a heart around my eye.
Yeah, that's what they're doing. They're painting hearts around their eyes. They're wearing spanglies and sparklies.
No, you don't. You're so upset about this whole thing that you won't even help a brother out.
What have you done for me?
Okay, hold on.
Wait,
hold on.
You may have opened the door. He's more connected than anyone in
the
world.
Okay, but exactly. What has he done for me?
Okay, I think
that's
coming
Taylor
right now.
Taylor Swift level S ticket.
Okay,
on the floor.
Listen, fair enough.
Listen up.
Fair enough.
Not in seats.
Fair enough. Stand by.
I'm not sure what's.
Oh,
happening.
This ain't gonna work. Okay.
Cappy says stand by. Yeah.
No, he's gonna make you an offer you can't refuse.
No,
he's got a sign.
It says top secret.
Turn every moment.
Oh, geez. Okay. He went to like Kinkles or something. No. CVS.
Nine.
Yeah, CVS and Taylor Swift.
Top secret.
All right, so what's in it, Cap?
Some top secret high-level information.
Really?
That's right.
Yeah. So what is it?
Oh, so this is the picture from last week at training camp
that
I signed for Aaron Donald.
I heard that was the stupidest thing ever.
Hey, did you go jeans with the suit jacket?
No, it's just like
are jeans with a suit jacket.
Yeah,
you're
really
doing
jeans, but
so explain this.
So this
you took
so what have you done
a long time ago with Aaron.
Wait,
Donald.
how does this affect Beto?
Yeah.
Well, no, it's what's in the top secret envelope.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. All right.
So there's a picture of me and Aaron Donald.
Six more minutes, John.
Okay. Oh, here's another thing that's in the top secret envelope. Geez. This is a picture
from Mandy's
one.
Oh, nice.
Mandy's one. This is me and Sedano.
Why don't you carry that? Why don't you get a wallet size of that?
That's a nice idea.
Have it in your wallet.
That's a nice
all
idea.
The time. Yeah.
You know, it's a really sweet idea. I'm going to put this in the office.
Okay,
all right.
Who's?
I like that.
You don't have an office here.
You don't have an office.
None of us do.
No.
Whose office are you going to put it in?
I put it in Lindsay Baseball's. Oh, okay. I've kind of taken over there.
That's Emily's office,
good.
Too.
You know, right. And then lastly, here's what else is in the top secret folder. And I want you to see this before Beto sees this.
Yeah. All right.
Look at this right here, Mace.
Oh, you.
Oh my.
Oh, Beto, if he cuts you in on this.
I actually spotted Beto.
If he cuts you in on this,
Beto,
you might go for it. You might go for it. What's the offer, Cap?
So Beto was there at Del Mar.
Ah, that don't count.
With his family.
Oh, get out of here.
Now listen, let me see if I can make a persuasive argument.
Make a persuasive argument.
Okay.
Let's go.
This horse right here, Raging Torrent.
Yes. Could be off the Kentucky Derby.
Beto brought us this good luck.
Yeah.
Okay.
We I didn't bet on the horse.
We won our first race.
Well, this is when you told me I don't feel good about this horse. My niece, the 10-year-old Maddie, said, we're not going to bet him, right? Nope.
This upcoming Sunday,
it'll be lost money.
This horse comes back to the track for a big, big stakes race down at Del Mar.
Yeah.
Beto, this picture is a gift from me to you.
Oh.
With nothing expected in return.
No strings attached.
But Beto, but can we agree that that day and your family there and you teaching your kids
sure
coming into the paddock and then the winner's circle and then in the picture, it was a great experience for you and your family, right?
Yeah.
I was so happy to be a part of it.
Yeah.
Just like I was with Mace.
You did. You showed us around.
Juan is still totally thrilled by the entire
thing. Hey, Mace, did you go to the clubhouse? Did you get clubhouse passes?
Clubhouse passes at Del Mar?
Yeah.
I don't know. We sat up in a box and then we
went down. Oh, I was general admission.
To the paddock. Oh, no. Were you really?
Oh, yeah. I bought my own tickets to general admission.
You know why?
I paid parking, too.
You know why? He told me.
He didn't ask.
No, because he told me he's teaching his kids that your first experience at the track, this is how we do it.
You gotta learn how to sneak in, baby.
Right. Yeah.
Gotta learn how to sneak in.
So now here,
so we snuck into the winning picture, even though we didn't bet.
Right.
Nice.
Now the horse comes back this Sunday. I want you and your family again to be my guest.
Sorry.
Okay. Unfortunately, you can't make it.
It's party of the year, John.
Is this it? By the way, it's party of the year. Is this it? In other words, if this horse wins, what?
If this horse wins, this horse is now kind of projected to be a Breeders' Cup.
So how
does
that get me making a phone call for Taylor Swift?
Okay, it doesn't. Here, this is a gift with no expectation.
This is my dad will love this.
With no expectation whatsoever.
Thank you, Cappy. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. So now that you know, you've asked, what have I done for you lately?
I've
just made. By the way, my boy Chris is listening too.
I just made your dad happy.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay.
So maybe. You say, hey, Cap's got all this FOMO. His daughter's going to Taylor Swift. Man, if he could get a ticket tonight or tomorrow night, he'd go and surprise his daughter. And if that were available, I would be indebted to you.
So,
Beto?
So
if somebody called
picture,
you with a free... Right, he
I
got
walked
you that picture.
Along with 40 other people in the picture.
Yeah. Right, but think about
Beto,
how happy your dad's going
to
be.
As you know, I compare everything to the West Wing. And there was one time on the West Wing that Martin Sheen needed help from the Republicans. And he went to a guy and he said, I need you to help me, one of his political enemies. He goes, I need you to help me on campaign finance reform. And the guy goes, what do I get in exchange? And Martin Sheen looked at him and went, the thanks of a grateful president.
Mm.
And the guy goes, good answer, sir.
That is a good answer.
So, Beto, what if you I think if you provide this ticket for Cap?
Oh my God! If you have the hookup, it's
what is he going to give me?
You would get the thanks of a grateful coworker.
He gave me a picture. He didn't say, "Hey, let's cut you into the winnings of this horse."
Oh, that's true.
Yet,
no, he didn't offer that at all.
I don't think he's going to offer.
He gave me a picture
from that.
Right.
Nice.
Which I could have gone to delmar.com and downloaded myself.
I don't think you can. Yeah, I don't think you can do that.
Delmar.com.
I don't think you can do that.
I was at delmar.com. I downloaded
I don't think you did.
Pictures.
No, you didn't.
And also,
no,
by the way,
they don't have
delmar.com.
First of all,
Cappy's
the president?
Wait, no, I'm saying.
This is the majority
Delmar.
Whip over here.
Yeah, no.
You're the president.
Yeah, but
I'm the minority whip. I'm the minority whip.
No, you're not the minority.
Hey, yes, I am.
Delmar, not a minority.
Hey, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Beto, do you know anybody more connected than Cap?
He does.
Batman right there.
Yeah, I know.
Steve Mischowski.
No, Cappy has a guy for everything.
We're still waiting to see that guy.
I'll tell you what.
Why does he not have a guy at Staples or Crypto or Taylor Swift tonight? Wherever is she at?
Well, I'll tell you what.
She's at SoFi.
There you go.
I could definitely put it this way. I would owe you a favor.
Oh, I don't want you to.
And you would at some point want to cash that in, and I'd be like, well, he needs that favor.
Like you know? I tell my guy Jess Ray, I'd rather owe you nothing.
Okay,
than
Beto,
owe you.
How about this?
Just be a nice guy.
How about this? Hey, Beto.
Chris, you're listening, right?
Call those. Get those tickets.
Beto, how much are you golfing these days?
Let me see. Those Callaway clubs that I've been waiting for that fitting for 2 years. Oh, no, don't have those.
No, Cap hooked me up with the Callaway guys.
He said that 2 years ago.
No.
And you could be swimming in golf balls if you come up with this Taylor Swift ticket.
I got my own logoed ones.
It only took me 6 months to get the hookup on Sunday Swagger stuff.
Oh,
but I came through.
You did come through.
You should have told me.
Yeah.
Hey, you get your Viore?
No, still haven't gotten
your Viore. Oh, look, just today I'm wearing my Viore.
Are you wearing your Viore?
Yeah,
thanks. One says they're sweatpants.
Thanks to my guy. Thanks to my guy Bob. Have you already hooked me up?
Yeah, they are sweatpants.
Cappy didn't.
Yeah. No, that's right. I didn't. You didn't ask, but I would have.
Yeah,
gladly.
Yeah,
I can't pick out your clothes for you, Mace. I can't do that.
Plus, you're shrinking.
Yeah. Hey, Mace. If we had a game between, you know, that game where you give somebody $5 and you see what they can turn it into.
Yeah,
like you trade like. I saw somebody.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I gave somebody a paperclip. I'll trade you a paperclip.
They ended up with a million dollar house.
Right.
That guy, yeah.
If we did that with with Cap versus Beto, who would win? We start him with $5 and we say,
you have a
month
to do what?
You have a month
to do what?
To trade up.
To trade up from $5
and to see what you have at the end of the month.
Oh, nice.
Who would win?
Very, very
I think Cap,
close.
He knows more rich people.
No, I think this is a good competition.
Although
he knows more rich people.
You know more overall people.
Yes, I know overall. I know uber rich people. Hey,
Pal
Gasol, can we go?
I don't think Cap would be honest about what he traded up for.
Well, you have to document it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Document it.
Why would I be dishonest?
Because he would do it to try and win.
Am I dishonest?
That's the whole point is to win.
Are you saying right off the bat?
So I'm the shady one.
Yeah, right.
Don't trust me.
Yeah, wait.
I trust Beto more than you.
Okay, good. Good. That's why I got
Lindsay,
more street cred.
Who would win?
Because I'm less trustworthy than Beto.
Congratulations,
Beto versus Cap on a trade-up thing. We give him each $5 and say, trade this for stuff.
Cap, I think that's going to be close, actually.
Right.
It's very close. And
I like that we both got a guy.
My initial thought was Cap, but I feel like... Because Cap's a good talker, but Beto has
hustler.
All the... Yeah, I know. I don't know.
I think it'd be very close.
I think Cap, because he has more rich people on his side.
No, I don't think so, man.
You could trade horses. I don't have that.
That's right.
Yeah. You got ringside seats.
I can trade jockeys. You can trade jockeys.
You heard what happened. Juan vetoed buying into the horse group.
Juan, let me tell you
something. But he got a massage chair out of it.
Good for you. Way better.
Such a smart move. I said, okay, it's $20,000. And he said, no. And I said, well, how about a massage chair? It's only 10. He goes, well, that's half the amount. So, yes.
That was brilliant.
Wait.
See, Mason can trade things
wait,
for...
Wait. Do you have the massage chair yet?
Not yet. We're working on it.
We're both going to get
here, John.
I'm going to make an offer to you.
Okay.
Oh, hey, better. You owe me for two
you
and a half.
You own a massage chair?
Nope.
And that Swifty traffic is going to get you.
Oh, no.
Get out of here.
What's the offer?
I'm going to make you an offer.
What?
You ready for this?
Here. I got a nice picture.
You went from $20,000 for horses to $10,000 for a massage chair.
Yep.
I'll sell you a quarter of a share of the horses for $5,000.
Oh.
A quarter of a share?
Yeah, so one share is $20,000.
I can get you a massage chair for $5,000.
Yeah, me too.
I'm going to run this back by the
No. Don't tell him.
Oh, don't.
Just find a chair for $5,000.
Actually,
there's a guy in Gardena that can do it.
No, the opposite.
There is a great showroom Gardena in Gardena.
Yes.
Gardena, guy's got it made.
Yeah, you tell him. You say, hey, I made a decision.
And I got a truck to deliver. Save you the delivery fee.
Or he'll do it for $200.
Right. Nah. He'll hurt his back. He's too skinny.
I'm doing both. You say to Juan, you go, Kaplan's going to sell me a quarter of a share for $5,000.
Yep.
And I'm getting a massage chair for $5,000.
Okay.
Got both for $10,000.
Do I get to go to the Kentucky Derby if Raging Torrent goes to the Kentucky Derby?
You and me are going together.
Oh.
On Friday.
Nice.
And you guys should come
Saturday
down Sunday.
Morning. Hope the flight's not late.
You should come down Sunday.
Yeah.
All right.
What do you guys got planned?
Best Clinton pal steaks?
Clinton Yates, baby. That's what we got.
Oh, CY's here?
Three-man week.
We're doing everything.
Oh, yeah. Today's going to be off the rails.
Yeah. Awesome.
This is real. Yeah.
I look forward to some radio off the rails next. We're back tomorrow at 1, Mason in Ireland, 710 ESPN.